Good afternoon and welcome to the Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing. I'm Michael Passingham. Joining me today are Oscar Hardwick and Lewis McGlade on this, yes, this rather epic race, round three of the Masters of Endurance 2014-2015 season, and the first race of 2015. We have a grid of 60 cars taking to the track today, and well, it's going to be an interesting one. Three races in a row, Team Redline have taken pole position, and that continues today with them taking pole position by just 0.026 of a second at this long circuit. I think we're going to be in for quite a close race today. I'm sure you guys would agree. I mean, the last two races have been sort of come down to the wire, and well, we've had some epic 24-hour races before in MOE in Live for Speed, but I expect this one will be about as epic.
I would believe so. I mean, it's lovely to see that in qualifying there are people within the same postcode as Team Redline now. Something that we really didn't see through the first couple of rounds of the season. If anything, that will make it closer, but it also makes Team Redline even less of a bet for the win, seeing as they've not yet converted any of their pole positions into race wins, with Coanda Simsport winning the first round and Iberica winning last time out at Suzuka.
Yeah. Redline still leading the championship, though, with 190 points because of their just utter consistency through the first two races and the 15 bonus points they've gained through three pole positions. And in fact, if they hadn't had those three pole positions, they would be tied for the championship lead with NX Racing Red. So, yeah, it's definitely an interesting set of circumstances. And you know, they could go the whole season without winning and still win the championship. It is about consistency. And this is a race where more points are awarded for winning.
Yeah, and just as a 24-hour race that we have today, and of course going into tomorrow, it's all about consistency over these races. Not pushing too hard, yeah, especially with things like track limits. And it's quite easy to push too hard at this track, especially with some of the higher speed corners. It's quite easy to make a small mistake, which then, you know, throws you into a wall, especially going up over Eau Rouge or, you know, even down the back of the circuit. There's plenty of places to make a mistake. And crash. So it's all going to be about consistency, not pushing the limits too hard, and just making sure that the car is brought home. And it's going to be interesting to see which ones do and which ones don't.
Yeah, indeed. And we had a few changes between last round and this round, some balance of performance changes. These are from iRacing, so the iRacing changed these. The BMW now has 10 more kilograms on board. But the iRacing guys have reduced the weight, so it should be the same. The MOE guys have reduced the weight back to how it was before, as far as I can tell. Full GT is 45 kilograms lighter. So, and that is actually shown through in their qualifying result. There's always one Ford. We love them. It's Glacier Racing in the Ford GT, and they're up in 17th, which is an impressive qualifying result, and possibly, you know, I'm sure they really appreciated the weight reduction, because that car was, well, they were really out-driving their car these first two races.
Yeah, well, the Ford GT is somewhat of a dog in terms of its handling characteristics. Obviously, this GT3 Ford, based off the GT2 Ford that was already in iRacing, and it's, again, even that, it's based off of a model of car that was just never strong in the series that it competed in. So the Ford is always going to be a struggle, and Glacier have been making it work for them so far. It will be interesting to see if they can do that again today over 24 hours, obviously a much longer period of time to keep your focus together. But we can keep our fingers crossed. We might even see them challenging the top five at some point.
Yeah, I think so. So in terms of if other changes, there had been some driver swapping bugs in the first couple of MOE races. They had affected some teams, and those should have been sorted now. And so that's good news, because the last thing you want is to have your race ruined by a in-game bug, because you have no control over that. So that's good news. Hopefully we won't see anything going too wrong today. We're looking at off tracks as well today. People should not be cutting the circuit, because there are plenty of places at Spa where you can drive off the road and make some time up. So there are six parts of the tracks which are being monitored by the admins, and warnings and drive-through penalties will be given out at the admin's discretion. And there are two fast tows you can use this time around if you have any major issues around the circuit, because it's not a great track to have an issue on, because you've got to drive a long way back to the pits if you have some major damage.
Yeah, having commentated the previous 24-hour race that was running iRacing here at Spa, it's such a demanding circuit. Now, granted, that was with three completely different car classes, whereas in MOE, it's only the GT3 class running. But I don't think that's going to take away from the amount of carnage you tend to see over such a long race distance, particularly at a track as challenging as Spa-Francorchamps.
Yeah, I mean, I've done quite a lot of races at this track, whether it's been an iRacing or an R-Factor or whatever, you know, loads of different cars, loads of different varieties, and it's all the same kind of thing. It's this track, although there's, you know, there's generally some corners quite a bit of runoff and stuff like that, it's actually really easy to make a mistake. Because the profile of some of these corners, it's just easy to throw the car in a little bit too hard than you think and go and find the wall. So keeping that together for the race and making sure that you don't bring anyone else into your incidents as well, because that's going to be a multiple car crash here is going to be pretty dreadful for probably more than two people, because people tend to get involved in other people's incidents if that happens.
Yeah, and then the last real life Spa 24, there were some numerous horrendous accidents for exactly that reason. Radion and around the circuit, some really horrible crashes.
I was going to say, that real world Spa 24 last year in 2014 reminded me very much of sim racing due to the number of completely unnecessary accidents going on. So I think, if anything, the guys on circuit today have a real opportunity to replicate a real world race and drive cleaner than the guys in that did. Because the real world Spa 24 last year was just, it was atrocious. So many of the accidents really did not need to happen.
Indeed. Well, yeah, I think the first two races of this season in MOE have been really, really clean and just some superb racing. A few collisions here and there, but I think they've only added to the spectacle. It's not been anything that we've sort of thought has ruined anything. I think it's been pretty enjoyable so far. The cars are now lining up behind the pace car, and they will make their way round to the start line, and the start line is after La Source, but the finish line, or the timing line, is where it would be in a standard Formula One race, so just after the final corner at the start of the pit wall. So, but yes, the race will start after La Source, so they don't all have to pile into that rather tight hairpin. It's probably for the best, although to be fair, all that means is that they end up driving into Eau Rouge side by side, so that could be interesting, and we'll keep a very close eye on what goes on there if all 60 cars make it through.
I'd be surprised if they did. I mean, even with people taking it easy, 60 cars through some of the tighter sections at Spa tends not to work out well.
Yeah, some of the thing is, if someone's going to take it easy, someone behind's not going to, and then yeah, it can quite easily turn into a very big mess. So I agree with Oscar. I would be surprised if all 60 got around the first lap comfortably. Not saying that it's impossible, and not saying that we don't have the talent on the field as it is, but just saying that it's probably unlikely is the best way of putting it.
So away we go in the formation lap. So we'll just take you through the first few positions on the grid. Starting the race for Team Redline is the pole time setter Enzo Benito, followed by Martin Kroenke for Coanda Simsport, who set the second fastest time, 0.026 behind Benito. And third, Iberica Racing Team. Fourth, GT Ross SST Orange, followed by their teammates GT Ross SST Silver. Coanda Simsport, the number 88 car, is sixth. Seventh is Inex Racing Red. Ninth is Team Camaro 2. Ninth is Vortex Sim Racing, and tenth is Pure Racing Team 1. So the cars are just heading up to La Source now. They will officially start the race after La Source when the lights go green. They're all trying to stay in order at the moment. You're currently seeing them coming through the chicane, that huge field of cars. Into the source they go. So Vinio heads them away. And they're away. Enzo Nuno gets a very good start indeed. Martin Funke is being pressured by Pablo Lopez from Iberica, who's passing him into on the outside, going into Eau Rouge, and has done so. So that's a change already, but there's 24 hours still to go, of course. And all the cars so far through Eau Rouge have made it. The first 15 or so, they're all through cleanly. In fact, they've all gone through pretty much line astern, which is probably quite sensible. And there's a huge amount of draft going down the front stretch, or the back stretch, I suppose. And, well, all the cars are panning out now as they head into the next set of corners. And Alvaro Romero attempting to take second position from Pablo Lopez, who maintains that in his roof. So, yeah, we've actually had a really clean start. But it's not over yet. The battle for second is pretty heated at the moment, as Enzo Benito just runs away with it, which has actually been a pattern for all three races so far. Enzo Benito always, you know, taking advantage of pole, always gets away, and he's probably 4 or 5 seconds up the road already.
Yeah, so when you've made a gap like that, it's quite good because he's getting close. I think he might have already possibly broken the draft, which we've been told around here is a very powerful thing. So maybe he's broken that, but maybe we'll get back under that. It's kind of hard to see. You've got a long way to go, and I'm fairly sure that this hasn't confirmed anything yet. We've got a long, long way to go in this race.
It's quite expected, though. You can see on the broadcast all those cars streaming through. It's quite something. So we're heading now down towards Blanchimont, and yet the lead is still Enzo Benito, followed by Iberica Racing for Pedro Lopez, Alvaro Romero for GT Ross SST, and Martin Krunker down in fourth for Commander SimSport after quite passive start, just making sure he got through the first lap without any incident. Plenty of time for him to take some more positions. Meanwhile, down in fifth, Cristian Guarenta is under pressure now from Isaac Price in MX Racing Red, who is possibly looking to make a pass going into La Source as we complete the first lap of this 24-hour race.
One down, and goodness knows how many to go then for all of these drivers. Fantastic start from Enzo Benito, not so much from Martin Krunker, who's fallen back a bit in the BMW, although, as has been discussed ever slightly, those roofs that have managed to get past him are considered the slightly quicker vehicle around Spa, although in the draft I don't think anyone's going to have a particular advantage over anyone else.
Yeah, all of the, you know, which one's fastest is all kind of negated when you're in someone else's draft and everyone's just, you know, quick.
And a pass for second position as Pablo Lopez gets passed by Alvaro Romero. That's a GT Ross SST Silver into second position.
I did see one car pulling in for pits right at the back of the field. I'm not sure if that was damage or some other problem. I couldn't see damage on the car, and by the time I actually saw the car, I couldn't work out who it was because it was in the white livery. So it looked mostly clean on that first lap, which is great news.
Looking through, there's a few cars that look to be in a spot of bother. 4 or 5 at the back that haven't had the best of time. But that said, there's 55 cars still within the same roughly half a minute, so that would suggest to me that about 55 of the 60-car grid have gotten through the first lap and a half without any issue.
Yeah, and that's the most important bit. This is the point where in the race, yeah, all of the cars are going to be the closest. When we get this close again, obviously that's as the whole grid is confirmed. I mean, I'm sure a few cars will be getting a bit closer, but across the grid, you know, this is the closest it's going to be. It's just going to spread out, probably get a bit calmer, and I think that the more tense part of the race is over for the most part.
So just a note from the race control: the cars that went into the pits could have been due to penalties. There are a number of cars which had issues in qualifying, but call it follow procedure correctly. Those cars, 49 CTT Racing, 76 Falcon GP, they were ordered to drive down the pit lane at the start, which they did. 92 Highland Racing, 97 KLT also were penalised, so we'll get full reasons on those soon enough. One team who I think did lose a fair amount of time was the GT Ross SST Silver team, who are, I think, down in 13th position. They had started the race in 5th, so they lost 8 places on that first lap. And a team that won a lot of places was Glacier Racing in Ford GT, the 41 car, now up into 12th position in that Ford. On screen, we're looking at the Iberica Racing team in their roof, being closely followed by the BMW of Martin Krunker in the Coanda SimSport car.
Further back, a big battle for 9th position. It's like 4 cars trying to have a go at Alexander Voss for Core Motorsports in the number 33 car. We've got 2 McLarens giving him absolute hell right behind them.
So the 97 KRT Motorsports car, which had to start from the pit lane, was a penalty carried over from Suzuka for avoidable contact in that race, if you can remember back that far.
I struggle to remember this morning, so I'm very glad that we have the race control here to inform us of various penalties and goings on that we simply haven't a clue about.
Yeah, it's a... So sometimes so much happens between all of the cars on the grid that we just can't keep track. I'm surprised there is people that can do so, but at the moment it does look like car number 26, Team Redline, is actually pulling away from the rest of the field, and the margin from what I can see is about 4.8 seconds as it stands, which is becoming quite a big margin.
Well, Forenzo is probably his strongest member of the Team Redline team. It's almost on him to produce some sort of gap for later drivers to be under less pressure to maintain position. And if anything, that's something that has thrown Team Redline off in the past, where maybe they should have had wins, but the gap just wasn't quite big enough to protect them from teams behind them that maybe had overall stronger groups of drivers on the day.
Yeah, but in the end, I guess they don't really mind. They're still championship leaders, and if they can score a decent position in this race, the amount of points that's worth in this race, it will still see them in good stead for the rest of the championship. As long you really just have to get a good position in this race, because it's worth so many points, it's a case of making sure you don't lose. It's a case of not losing too many. You don't have to win as long as you don't lose all your points. As long as you don't retire and lose a huge chunk of your potential score.
Absolutely correct. Yeah, you just need to get to the end of this one, because You know, if you can stay consistent and stay out of the walls, and if, you know, I've not done very much endurance racing, I've only managed a little bit of it. But you know, as long as you can keep it out of the wall, you know, keep consistent, keep on track. It's the most important thing. You know, you'll actually be guaranteeing yourself a good position, because money says that not everyone else will. You know, you can put yourself in actually a really comfortable position in the race if you just don't crash. You know, if you just keep it out of the wall, keep it away from them, and just, you know, just keep to your own game, as it were.
So you're watching the battle for second making its way into the downhill section of the circuit now. And that's Stavolo, they're coming through. So we've battled down in 19th position, 114 in McLaren, the Vortex Sim Racing car of Denis Gurdes, versus Stefan Muliskular of Virgil Racing, and Antti Viala from New World SimSport. And around the outside goes Stefan in that Virgil Racing roof at the bus stop chicane. A good move there. That was that gives him, I think, 17th position. Look at that train of cars behind me, spectacular. They're still sort of, they're within driving distance, whereas Piala takes a wide line and actually loses the position there to the Pure Racing team number 3, car 59 of Sven Kresma, who is on the outside going into the first part of the Eau Rouge and now takes that position.
Indeed, there was was a good move. But looking at just quickly about the front and where all the times are, I'm just looking at it. The Team Redline car is getting slower and slower and slower per lap. But everyone else is standing around consistency, so I'm wondering if that Team Redline is going to start falling back into the clutches of car 113. I wonder if we're going to see that Team Redline running away at the start and then just being pulled back, as we saw back in say, Grand America.
Certainly a possibility. I mean, looking at the early pace that Enzo was setting, he's already fallen to be about half a second, 0.6 of a second off of that on his last lap. So that's still lapping quicker than everyone behind him, but it's not lapping substantially quicker. And like you say, you almost expect to start seeing a crossover in those times as maybe the roofs behind come further into view of Enzo's rear mirror, also having been told prior to the race by some of our more knowledgeable members of the race admin crew that the McLarens really do burn up their front tyres around here, so be interesting to watch.
We have a battle going on there. You can see on screen at the head of the bus chicane, Martin Krunker looking to take position 4 from Pablo Lopez, and Lopez in fact in that Iberica roof loses 2 positions as Isaac Price in the NX Racing red car also goes through. Stayed out of the way. That American car had started in 3rd. Is now 5th, so still definitely in the hunt.
Yeah, just got a bit spooked, I think, in the second part of the first stop there by Kronker coming up the inside, and the car went a little bit lower on the rear end.
So we'll just give you a quick rundown of the order after after 5 laps. So it's Team Redline leading, GT Ross, SST Silver in 2nd.
Oh, we've had a big off further back. Dirk Reinhardt, Jan V. Merkatz both involved. And it looks like we've got a roofing trouble that's been caught up in that as well. It's Adrian Davey of GTRS Orange. That would be numbers 132. I'm looking through for the other numbers. Number 40 and number 60, I'm being told. Indeed, it is number 60, the Trinity Motorsports BMW that's actually pulled over and looks like it's going to be escaping back to the pit lane and using up one of those fast tows.
Oh, you don't really want to be using those this early. Those are the kind of things that you want to use as, you know, as effectively desperate measures later on in the race. You don't want to use them now. You don't want to waste them on small stuff in the first hour. You want to use them on, you know, things when you're like 12 or 13 hours into the race and you've made quite a massive cock-up. And that's where you want to be using them, not this early.
Completely right. I mean, basically, if possible, splitting it up. Like, obviously, if possible, not using either. But you only want one of those fast tows to affect maybe the first half of the race and keep the other for the second. The problem being, you get one little bit of damage, and when you go to your pit stop, it's going to repair it as one of your fast tows.
Yeah, indeed. It's, as I say, those are the kind of things that you want to use. I think it's just the thing as a driver, you know, when you've got it in the back of your mind where you know you can make a mistake, you're actually less likely to, for the most part. Obviously, some drivers will use that excuse to push far too hard, but for most drivers, when you know that you can make a mistake and it's not the end of the world, it's just a bit more comfortable like that, because, you know, you're not pushing too hard. You're not constantly thinking about it, though. Your mind is constantly on the track. You're not always thinking, oh, if I make a mistake here, then, yeah, that's it, really. So It's just an interesting way of going about it. But, yeah, it's just about keeping your mind on track and not letting these things get to you.
I on a fairly irregular basis do some, or have done, lead racing in the past. I do not handle pressure at all well. Like, I'm pretty much shaking from the start to the end. I don't know how I managed to stay on track. I need the biggest dead zone in my steering wheel ever to stop myself from driving off road. So these guys I have massive admiration for.
Yeah, I have the same thing. We did a race on Wednesday and I let the pressure get to me and I punted off two people like an absolute idiot. Yeah,
it's very impressive just, to watch.
Yeah, cheers, Oscar. Thank you. But it's just letting that pressure get to you is sometimes so easy. You know, I remember going into like some turns and just the whole body shaking, like my left foot on the brake and it's shaking all over the place. And it's just about just taking deep breaths and trying to just be calm about everything.
On screen right now, you're watching Dylan Sharman defending his Team TCL's position 8 from Alexander Voss and Cole Motorsports 33 Roof, which is in P9, as they head into the first corner.
Oh, I see Glacier Racing's gone up to 10th already.
Yeah, that's a really good game. Four,
yeah. Yeah, just saw that in the background. That's a really good game so far. And keeping on chugging along, I believe their fast lap at the moment is 19, which... it's fairly decent. I saw a couple of 20s around that area as lap time wise, so they're pushing on, and that's some good stuff right there.
Yeah, they're on pace to be in the top 10 by all stretch. I mean, it's very good times to be set in those 19.6s, particularly in the fourth.
156 miles an hour, the top speed on that particular run just then down the straight. The car ahead, Alexander Voss, had reached 158 miles an hour, but that was helpful from the draft. So yeah, that Glacier Racing definitely more slippery like a glacier, I suppose.
It's we've seen this absolute consistency from these guys over the previous two rounds. Why they've had some pretty decent results, and yeah, they just seem to just keep to themselves. You know, they're not getting involved with too many other people, they're not pushing themselves into incidents or anything like that. They're just keeping calm, and you know, they're just bringing this car, which I believe even now it is still the only Ford on the grid as the background. Two McLarens going wheel to wheel, but it's, you know, the Ford, it seems to be the only Ford, if I recall correctly. It definitely was back in Road America, and you know, they're doing a really good.
Yep, they're the only Ford even to have attempted to qualify in this round. So yeah, continue to do the blue oval a big honour. Just ahead of them, there was a pass for position 8. Alexander Voss in that corner, Sports car, did eventually get past Dylan Sharman in the 91 McLaren TTL car. Meanwhile, you're watching Simon Trendle defending from Patrick Pichler in the Pure Racing car, and Pichler goes up the inside of the bus stop, but Trendle keeps the inside line for the second element of that chicane and stays ahead in his Camara McLaren in P11.
Yeah, I believe that. I honestly cannot remember which team's which, but I think it's Team Camara that Ben Tusting drives for, and we saw back in Road America him doing a great job for that team, and of course at Suzuki. You know, we see him, he's very quick, he's their fastest driver of fire. Memory serves me correctly, so when he's in that car, hopefully that'll move even further forward. But they're actually in a really good position at the moment, sitting in 11th.
Yeah, they had a bit of a troublesome Suzuka. They finished 33rd, five laps down. But yeah, indeed, they had a much better time at Road America, where they were 18th in the end after coming back through the field. Heard of change for, I think, position 6.
5, yeah.
John Grez just got past Pablo Lopez, so that is a pass. Vortex Sim Racing passes Iberica for P5, that is. And we just heard that possibly the leader, Enzo Benito, just had a slow sector, possibly due to a iRacing mandated slowdown.
Yeah, it was 3 seconds off in the first sector compared to previous. So the gap is actually down to 3.3 seconds as of the moment. So that's the first mistake. I mean, whatever happened, there was a mistake there. You know, whether it was a slowdown or whatever, there was definitely a mistake there. So the first one there coming from Team Redline, and well, whether they'll make any more like that, we'll. It's going to cost them if they keep doing it.
And the number 8 in X Racing blue car, the next to be putting some pretty severe pressure onto Pablo Lopez. That American Racing Team car seemingly struggling a little bit. Started very well and has fallen back to 6th, looking like it will probably fall back to 7th in the next couple of laps as well.
Yeah, also the Team Car America looking possibly to go down a position. Here on the Pure Racing Team car as we head down into La Source, and through it goes.
Just a quick note on that slowdown. It was, Benito went through Eau Rouge, cut it, not much more than most people had, but cut it just enough to have to slow down back down the back straight, so that's why he lost so much time.
Yeah, it's a very easy thing to do, particularly when in an event that's competitive, you're obviously having to push to the absolute limit on every single lap that you're doing, particularly early on, to build gaps and get yourself in the position you want to be in. It's tricky to see as Simon Trendall under pressure again, this time from Harald Stadler in the number 3 car just behind the All-Star Racing Team. If anything, it was a look that came about him defending from the GTROS SST orange car that I think after its slightly dodgy start has started to get itself back in the air again.
Yeah, so you can see that car number 3 now attempting to make a pass. They go into that fast left-hander at Blanchimont, I believe.
Puan,
sorry. I'll get there eventually. They're still side by side. Stadler now going around the outside of the Camaro car, but didn't quite manage to make it as they now continue through into Stavolo and down the hill into Blanchimont. Bit of damage on that All-Star Racing roof.
I think it was actually from when the two McLarens went side by side through the bus stop a couple of laps prior. And it stacked up the two roofs behind, causing a nose-to-rear bumper contact. A small one, but contact nonetheless.
Yeah, it looks probably shouldn't affect him too much. There'll be a little bit of it'll be slightly noticeable, but probably not massively noticeable as one roof under attack from the other. But nothing really changing at the moment. I think everyone is just keeping a little bit calmer than normal, just to bring it home.
That All-Star car in the third quarter started 18th, so up 5 in the first 27 minutes. So he's Infinity Esports in that green BMW. This is Mika Hapanen. He was of those names. You have to read the whole name before you actually try and say it, otherwise you get bogged down partway through the word, but yes, I got through there. So yeah, he's currently sitting in P29 in that Infinity Esports car, and there's a whole load of cars in front and behind him. It's a good place to be. It's exactly it's what you would define as the midfield, and it's pretty crowded out there.
Very crowded, and if anything, it's not more skill, but it's a different skill that the drivers in these packs have to be exerting than, say, Enzo off by himself at the front. Here, it's all about the awareness of the other vehicles around you, because as soon as you make contact, it's not just going to be a little tap and half spin. You're going to have the other 10 people behind pile in, and I mean, you're really in a position to make things come across as race ending. And as I said, that we had Johan Lepinazzi for JCL Sim Racing 2, the number 131 car, have a very late lunge. If anything, it looked like he locked the rears a bit going in to, and that was turn 5, having a look at the Infinity Esports racing car.
Yeah, it goes into Lake Homme, and Just got a little bit wrong, and luckily no one was taken off the track in that incident. But it's to be honest, especially at Le Commerce, sorry, Formula One, it's quite easy to make a small mistake there and cost yourself the entire race. Obviously, this is a 24-hour race; that is a 2-hour race. But you know, even then, you can do yourself irreparable damage this early on in the race that you just can't bounce back from.
So we're now looking back up at the near the front of the field. P6, Iberica Racing Team, was under pressure from Joel Gwiz and the Vortex Sim Racing McLaren. Behind them, Robin Fiskops in the NX Racing Blue as they all head into the source. So it was a pass you just saw the end of. It was, yeah, so that was Pablo Lopez taking that fifth, and taking fifth, in fact, as they went on to the start of the new lap. And he's now pulling away, in fact, in that roof. And it is, Robin Fiskops is now going to be putting Gwiz in that Vortex car under pressure as they head into Le Coum. And the draft, this is one of the best places to see how effective that draft is. I mean, Gwiz in that McLaren was a long way behind the roof, but still you could see he had 2 or 3 miles an hour on the roof in front, just purely through draft. You know, Robin Fiskops, who had looked to be putting them under pressure in his BMW, has had a slowdown, it looks like, through onto the back straight through Raglan. I think he might have cut the corner. And that's put him into the hands of, into the clutches of Alexander Voss in the corner of the 33 roof.
Yeah, and just look at the background of these three. You do have that Glacier Racing car that, yeah, we did see it broken away from the pack behind, has now caught up to this pack. So clearly that Ford GT is showing some very good pace at the moment. But Alex Voss looking right on the back of that NX Racing Blue car, and looking like it might actually take advantage of the situation and go for a move at some point pretty soon. It could actually be down to the bus stop chicane after this, because obviously how strong the draft is at this track.
Yeah, Voss was a little faster than the previous lap, so I think he has the outright pace, and I think the slowdown for Fiskops just sort of accelerated the process of him being caught by Voss.
Absolutely.
Heading into the bus stop now. Fiskops has a little bit of a gap. We can have a bit of
breathing. Background. Glacier Racing car going for it. And I believe it's through. Yeah, it is. The Glacier Racing car up to ninth position in the background there. Getting past the McLaren of Team TTL. Good move there. Good clean move into the bus stop chicane, moving its way even further up the order.
Yep, P9. Not bad at all. And yeah, Voss now in that 33 Ford Motorsports car looks to be, if he gets a good run through Eau Rouge, could have a good chance if they go into Le Coum next time around. But getting it right through here is difficult, because there's so many different lines you can take, and it really depends on what the guy in front of you is taking as to whether your line is as effective as theirs, especially when you get caught up in their draft mid-corner.
Certainly is. Just a few things worth mentioning. You want to send questions, give comment on the race, hashtag IRMOE on Twitter or at Masters of NU. We'll certainly see it at some point. A couple of shout outs to Omar Soto and Samuel De La Fuente, both watching the broadcast on various different bits and bobs, getting themselves up in and enjoying the race.
I would check Twitter, however, not really a Twitter user, so that might be up to one of you two.
You are old-fashioned and out.
Very much so.
It's all good. I got Twitter. I'm watching it.
So we have a battle between the light blue McLaren on screen, Luis Rodriguez in the Ham Endurance team, followed by Antti Piala in the New World SimSport McLaren. This is a battle for 18th position. As they went through there were some skid marks ahead. Someone has had an incident, I think, at the exit, or partway through, I think that's Stavlo, right?
I believe so, but I think, here's the thing with the 78 car, I think that was one of the cars that got the 10 place grid drop, if I read what
it was indeed
correctly. So
were dropped 10 places on the grid.
So bouncing back from that fairly nicely.
Yeah. So yeah, they had Hammond Endurance had been they started 24th and yeah, now P18, so looking good, but yeah, they were under pressure from the new Wilson Sport car, and on the last lap they were just a little bit, well, they, in fact, they lapped about half a second slower, and now the lap times have changed, and they lapped a little faster, actually, having to assume, than the new world Sims Walk car, so they're just getting away a little bit.
Currently passing through roughly what will be the halfway point of everybody's stint, under the impression that cars will generally be doing 26, maybe 27 lap stints. We'll see the 27 lap stints more often with the roofs than the other guys. You really have to work the fuel clever with the BMW McLaren to pull that one off. So about halfway through the stint, which makes perfect sense as we have just gotten halfway through the first hour of the 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps presented by Blue Front Racing.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing I'd note from this is, you know, this is basically the big storyline that we see from this is about Team Redline and how they're going about this. And although they are slightly pulling out the gap over the 113 car, but they're not running away with it. There was a slight mistake in the second sector on this lap from the roof, but it dropped them back a further 0.3. However, you know, on the previous lap and the lap before, the G-Tross SST Silver car was actually a tiny bit faster, about half a tenth faster. But you know, they're really not letting the Team Redline car run away with this, and so maybe through stops and strategy, we might see something. That's a classic racing car is having a look again on the straight through. As I believe that one was handed to them as they move up into P8.
There is some conversation going on in the server between admins and drivers about the way iRacing is handling the corner cutting and how black flags are supposed to be cleared. So, yeah, it looks like people are pushing a little harder than was expected, and there are, the admins are just saying, just don't take the corner as tight, because if everyone keeps doing it, it's going to be pretty difficult to clear all the black flags all the time. So the driver's going to have to shift the way they drive to avoid getting those slowdowns.
Yeah, so an added challenge for the people taking part in the event. Not really what they could have wanted. And just, again, as we've seen last year, move up to 8th last lap. Fantastic run so far for 4GT. It seems, if anything, to be a lot stronger in this racing situation than it was in qualifying, maybe maintaining its tyres better than the other GT3 cars that it's up against.
Yeah, whatever it is, whether it's the car, whether it's Vassi Racing as the team, or you know, something else, that car just it is a better race car than it is a qualifying car. You know, it's always the one that we see climbing the most positions. It's always the one that you see higher up than its qualifying position by quite some margin. You know, it's I think Road America, they qualified at like 40 something, and they got themselves into the top 10, if I recall correctly, or very close to it.
I think that's right. Yeah.
I think they got into the top 10 at the end, and you know, it's just, and now we're seeing them here, and they've already, and we've been doing this for just over half an hour, and they've already moved themselves into P8 in that 41 car. That's a fantastic drive. So it's shown that this Ford GT really is a good race car.
So we just about to head on to lap number, 15, I believe. So I'll just give you a quick round up of the top 10. I was going to do that earlier, then some like action and things happened, so that was more important. So Team Redline leads the race. GT Ross SST Silver is in second. Commander SimSport third. InX Racing Red fourth. Fifth Iberica Racing Team. Sixth Vortex Sim Racing. Seventh InX Racing Blue. Eighth Glacier Racing. Ninth Core Motorsports. And tenth Team TTL. So that's a run-up of the top 10. Representatives from all the four types of car in this race, McLaren's, Wolf, BMW and Ford GT, all in the top 10. The top 10 are covered by 20 seconds at the moment, or 21 seconds, in fact. And Team Redline's lead, Enzo Benito, behind the wheel, 4.3 seconds ahead of Alvaro Romero in that GT Ross SST silver car.
I think we're going to see a move made for 7th position pretty soon. The Glacier Racing 4GT not giving up just yet, applying the pressure to Robin Friscops in the number 8 Inex Racing blue car pretty severely. If anything, I would say going through Sector 3 this one could be sealed and delivered.
Yeah, it looks, based on where he's been making his move across this stint, I would assume possibly into the final turn. Will that 4GT move up into P7? And it's kind of like, it's just one of those things that you're looking at going, it's kind of inevitable at the moment. You know, it's looking at that car and it's just moving up so many positions that it just looks like, I'm not saying it's going to be fairly easy, but it just looks like almost a done deal, as it were, even at this point, that that Glacier Racing car will be passed at the end of this lap.
I mean, it's another thing that's worth pointing out is that Ford GT has such a lower, slippier profile to it than the other cars. And I feel as though its straight line speed, its ability to use the draft of the blockier cars, is probably making it even more of a threat to people in these stages of the race.
Absolutely, it could possibly be that indeed. Just looking at it in the top 10, it seems like it is the car running closest to its fastest lap time consistently. Are we going to see a move? No, he's just letting it slide at the moment and not going for that move as of this early. I think he had a quite good run out of the Paul Ferrer curve, so you know, just biding his time is Alexi Lohmé.
Yeah, riding on board, that's our first on board of the race. Taking you round this fantastic track, one of the best tracks in the world, I would say. And just some great tracks in the calendar this year, in fact. Picking the pick of the bunch. And I guess while we... So just looking ahead, we're currently round 3 of the series. The next round, this round supported by Blue Flag Racing, next round of the series is the 6 hours of the Circuit of the Americas, as Lohmé from Glacier Racing passes Inex Racing Blue, who I think had a slowdown, lost a lot of time. So that's a pass.
Yeah, that is. Well, that does have a slowdown based on where he is, but either way, there was a mistake. Maybe not starting because he didn't drop that far back. It's a weird one, that. But yes, moving up into that 7th position, keeping everyone under pressure and moving on up the order. So clearly, looking like this is going to be one that we may see in a fairly decent position later on in the race. I think we talked about this. Possibly getting a top 5, and you know, I honestly felt it was fairly unlikely, but here it is running in 7th, so it's only 2 positions away and not that far down the road, so really, really solid run so far.
Indeed, and just before that move happened, I was just telling you what the rest of the calendar for this year is going to be, but round 3, there's 2 more rounds to go, 6 hours of Circuit of the Americas coming up on Saturday the 31st of January at 1600 UTC, same time as this race. Today, that race will be sponsored by GrandPrix247.com, and then on Saturday the 21st of February at 1600 UTC is the 6 hours of Bathurst, sponsored by IGP Manager. So that is, well, both of these will be ones to look forward to. Those dates, I'm being told, are still TBC, just because of possible scheduling conflicts with the 24 Hours of Daytona race, the official iRacing race. So we'll let you know what those exact race dates are when they happen. But for now, that's what the track's going to be anyway. So now you know. The more you know.
Indeed, a good calendar still to go, not long left on it. And it's races like this where you cannot afford to make a mistake, especially considering there's not too much room to pull it back. So it's all about just not messing up, as we are not seeing anyone in the top lot mess up so much. What I have seen is the fastest of the top five on that lap was the number 18 Calendar SimSport, going a little bit quickly in comparison to the others, and they're all running roughly the same time. So maybe those tyres of the Team Redline car are dropping off a little bit. There is the Calendar SimSport number 18, but maybe those tyres are dropping off. We said that McLaren might chew its front tyres up a bit more than the other cars, so that's quite possibly what we're seeing, because that, I think, the Team Redline is running the furthest off its best time. It's running about 2 seconds slower than its best time, whereas most other people are running, you know, 1 second off or less. So that's a big gap, although it must be said, it's the fastest time for that McLaren was a second faster than anyone else has gotten so far, so that could be why.
Enzo sort of needs to work the gap as much as he can, as probably the quickest member of Team Redline's endurance team at the moment. So he worked very well early on in the race, and obviously that slowdown sort of caught him off guard a bit, and there's a 19.4, which I believe is still the quickest of the time set by anyone in that top sort of group. Although open margin, 1/100th quicker than Alvaro Romero in the number 113 roof just behind.
Yeah, clearly showing that DT Ross SST silver car is one that we're going to have to keep an eye on, especially if, as we've been told, that the roofs generally can go about a lap further, which, yeah, obviously wide laps, not too big at the start of the race, but that could be a really big deal later on in the race. You know, when you're talking on the final stint, you know, it's a long way to go, and they've got to keep out of trouble until then. But, you know, all the way until that part of the race, that could be a really, really big deal. Just that one extra lap every single stint, you know, translates into quite a big chunk of time, as the Inex Racing red car went quite wide out of Lake on there.
Just trying to get a grasp on the current retirements from this race. There are 57 cars still running. Dream Factory is the last placed car, 57th, and then 58th. Let's have a look. Oh no, well, no, they seem to be still running. I think there might have only been one retirement so far.
CTC Racing 1, yeah.
Yeah, might.
Oh, which isn't a retirement, as apparently CTC Racing 1 is a junior team, and that's completely correct, as they are currently running 56th and 1 minute 56 seconds down on the league.
So that leaves 59 cars then, according to the live timer. 59 cars still in this race, although I can't actually navigate to them in iRacing, so goodness knows where they are.
Indeed, only a couple of them have. Apparently, they've actually gone a lap down, which is amazing because I haven't seen anyone. So I see that will probably be in pit lane where they achieve that. As I have not seen either of them go a lap down, I'm sure I would have shouted about a position change, but it wasn't. But yeah, at the moment, it's not too many DNFs. I believe in Road America we didn't have one until quite late, and I don't know, I can't remember how many we had in Road America. I think it was like 15 or 20. I will go and check that in just a moment. But, I don't know how many DNFs we're going to have for this, but hopefully as low as possible.
Yeah, indeed. I think we're looking at it.
We were just looking at about 14.
Sorry, currently you're watching the battle for 14th position. Simon Trendle in the Team Camara car, coming out of Eau Rouge. Harold Stadler in the All-Star Racing Team. Roof in 15th, being challenged by Paul the Brink of the Radicals Online to Roof. Up the inside into Lecoum, gets the inside into the right-hand element and stays ahead from the left. Going down into Bruchel, the right-handed hairpin. Lovely corner this one. Difficult, but very interesting. Downhill challenge as the car washes out as you exit the corner and through the left-hander. And down to Pouhon. One of the scariest corners around. Meanwhile, you can see there now Ulrich, who made one pass already, is now going to make another, or at least is trying to, on Simon Trendle's Team Camara number 54 car. It's very, very close as they come through Fagnier and into Stavelot.
Yes, looking like this could be a position change at some point. Obviously, very, very close. I believe this Team Camara 2 car has gone backwards quite a few positions. We saw it close to the top 10 earlier on in the race and dropping back slightly as that is getting very, very close to the head towards Bonjamont. And there they go. It's quite close enough this lap for a move, unless it's going to be a big old dive bomb. He's not going to throw it down the inside yet, it's too much risk in doing so. As a background, we've got the BMW with the roof going wheel to wheel and no move coming from it.
Those two cars are the New World Sports car of Antti Piala in P18 and the Sven Kresma Pure Racing BMW in P17. They were going side by side, but yes, no position change just yet. As we continue to watch Ulbricht's Radical Online rough challenge for that 14th position.
I also believe we're being told there is a, I believe that means there's a drive-through for the 38. Which the 38 is quite well out of contention. It's down in 37th position, the slow Finns car. They're for contact with the 22 car on that line at Lecombe.
I think that's the point of the incident that we saw the end of, where there was a car stuck in the middle of the chicane.
Yeah. So there we go, we've got the race admins right on it, handing out penalties where they are fairly due. Something's happened in the lead area as the GT Ross SST silver car has actually dropped back. The gap was 4 seconds last time I saw it, it's now 7.2. So something's clearly happened there.
I put my money on a slowdown, but I'll have a look.
It looks like, based on the sector one time, it does look like a slowdown. So. Clearly pushing it a little bit too far, I would assume, over Eau Rouge. And paying the price for that one as being forced to drop back a hard-earned 4 and a bit second gap to 7.4 seconds as we look back at the Team Camara 2 car that is well under pressure from the 35.
Yeah, just to clarify, was another slowdown through Eau Rouge, same as everyone else pretty much had to. So I'm at about 30 miles an hour going down straight into Lecoum, but at least there was no one around. But now he's only a couple of seconds ahead of the kind of SimSport car. Meanwhile, we continue to watch that Radicals Online battle, attempting that 14th position, and Simon Trendle gets sideways.
Ooh, big wiggle there.
Yeah, he really, that was not the place to go sideways. That was
he's going on track for back. Oh, I think there might be contact there.
Not on my screen, I think he just got away with it.
Yeah, I think it just looked really, really close from the angle I saw it.
Yeah, that car coming in behind that roof is the Harold Stadler All-Star Racing Team 1 car number 3, which is a piece of team trying to take advantage of Trendle's big mistake. Well, small mistake, but could have been a very big mistake.
Just a mistake. The fastest turn on this track, it's absolutely terrifying. Going through there, you go through there in a lot of different cars and it's different in every single one. Some it's flat, some it's not, and possibly pushed a little bit too hard, and when you do, that was one mighty wiggle and a very good save to have collected it all and actually held the position, or at least, you know, only dropped back one position from that, because it's very easy to have binned it. And we're also being told that Endo had an oversteer moment fairly similar to that on his pawn lap, which you can watch on the YouTube channel of Masters of Endurance.
If you go to mastersofendurance.net/qualify and then click on Enzo Benito's qualifying time, you'll be able to go see the YouTube video of his pole lap. Always a good watch, as Simon Trendle, I think, again, running a little bit wide. I think through Pouan, through the exit of Pouan. And just going back to the mistake that he made, yeah, he had a little lift on the previous lap, which just unsettled the car, and that's what sent him off the road, but got away with it. Just.
Yeah, this is looking like quite the pack is building here, I'm a fan of pack racing. I don't really like it because it's terrifying, and so, you know, when you've got so much on the line, we're still within the first hour of this race here, still got 23 hours to go, and when you're driving around with five or six other people, which, you know, we're getting quite a train here. You know, it's so easy for one person to be too busy thinking about it and make a mistake. We've got a dive bomb. Oh, that is one late lunge.
Yes, it's a move. And that's the Pure Racing Team number 3, the car 59 car of Sven Kresma. Almost managed to get a position himself. That would have been P16, but just backed out of it. But yeah, that was a really, really late lunge from Stedler, who is now in 15th.
Yes, but to be honest, I think it's fairly odd to see that kind of stuff in endurance racing, but I think he's seeing the opportunity that this Team Primera 2 car is a little slower than he, and need to get past ASAP, and, you know, has made that move work, made that move stick, their contact, you know, it was fine as it goes. It was in the background, we've got
Pilaya.
Yes.
Pilaha, even, of New Watson Sport. That McLaren going the outside of Kresma, who looked like he was going to try and get 16th, and has now ended up losing the position down the straight into Lecoum. And the New Watson Sport car just managed to slow it down, going into Lecoum, just got away with it, and took that 17th position. And Kresma now under threat from JCL Sim Racing, Sylvain Pomerard in the car 19. It's a five-car train.
It's more than that now.
Oh yeah, and we've also got
Rodriguez. There's a solid 8-car train right there.
Yeah.
That is a train. Yeah, this is very uncomfortable. If, like, I mean, in this kind of train, I'd either like to be at the front or at the back. I do not like being in the middle, because the middle is where, if something, I mean, at the back, if something goes wrong, you get caught up in it. But, you know, at least you can lift, you can back off, you can have some space. Whereas if you're in the middle, you don't really have that luxury, so. You know, this is the kind of situation where I'd actually rather be at the back of the train or the front. You know, I don't want to be in the middle at all.
Yeah, of the cars in that train, I think it's Pomerard in the JCL Sim Racing BMW and car 19, who looks to be the most racy. He's trying to find a way past Kresma, and was lunging around. And as they head now down the mountain, I think, into Blanchimont, it's also, yeah, but they're spreading out a little bit. Oh, and in fact, wide has gone Harold Stadler in the All-Star Racing Team, just out of the exit of Blanchimont, and has to take a defensive line into the chicane. Gets away with it, but I think out of the chicane, he's going to have some problems. And I think through and after the thoughts, we've definitely had a Simon Trendle McLaren all over him. Trendle breaks a little early into the source to give himself a better run. Not sure if he took full advantage there, because I think Stedler actually had a pretty good exit from the source there. Meanwhile, behind Piala, you can see on the right, is now side by side, but now Trendle is also trying to go through on the inside, and they're going to go almost three wide into Lecoum. And sadly, just breaks later than them. And I think Trendle backed out a little bit there. Piala is now through into position 15. Somehow, Stadler managed to stay ahead there.
In all honesty, I think that was very, very good judgment from the 54 guy. That was a bit of contact indeed.
And that's pushed. That's
Camaro two cars back through. Oh, no.
And round the side outside. Side. Yeah, exactly. Round the outside goes Trendle, who makes back two positions after contact between Piala and Stadler. And Trendle finds himself back in 15th, a 14th that he'd lost just a few corners previously. And yeah, it was a bit of contact that sent the two cars wide. And yeah, Trendle took full advantage and now getting away from them.
Yeah, as I was going to say, I think that was actually a really good judgment from Trendle there. Coming into Les Commios, he was like, I'm right on the inside. This could be a crash. You know, he even gave up a position, which, you know, it was just like really using his head in this kind of race. You don't need to put the car in that much risk this early on. And so he just lifted, let the cars go, and, you know, luck prevailed in that for him as he gained the positions back, both of them. The position he was going to gain and the one that he lost. So, you know, running back in the 14th position in that 54 car.
Pilaha now trying to do the outside move and on Stadler, and it's going to stay on the inside. In fact, Stadler pulls
into the pits. Yes. So it's our first stop of the lot when we thought these routes were going to go a bit longer. This one clearly going against that knowledge, and their pit lane here is extremely long. It's the, I believe it's the Grand Prix pit lane and the endurance pit lane, which is a very long pit lane. That's apparently roughly 90 seconds. That is a long stop. That's, almost, not quite, about 50 seconds off. That's almost a lap. Losing in one stop, so that's a big loss here. Obviously everyone has to do it, but if you can strategize your way into doing one less stop, you'll think that's 1 minute and 30 seconds you'd gain.
Yeah, it's definitely worth trying to do. And yeah, some of the guys might not want to push so hard. Like if they can lose less than 90 seconds over the course of the race by just being slightly slower and saving a little bit of fuel, they could give themselves a fair few positions.
Indeed, but we are very quickly approaching this pit stop window for the entire field. We said there it's going to be 26, 27. I think we've just done lap 24, and so we're very much in this window, very, very close to it, of where we expect people to stop. So obviously that move not too far out of trend, and maybe just trying something a bit different to find their way to a slight advantage. Apparently the leader pits of Enzo Benito.
Enzo Benito now pulls into the pit lane after 25 laps. 1 hour, 1 minute and a half as he trundles his way down the pit lane. So who else have we got in? We've also got the SRP Sim Racing Portugal 133. No one else as yet, although the leaders are now coming round, so who else is going to come in? Core Motorsport stays out, Iberica stays out. InX Racing Blue stays out, Vortex stays out, Team TTL in ninth comes in. That's Dylan Sharman for a pit stop.
Yeah, I think it's, I'm strategy-wise, I'm sure all these guys know what they're doing, but from what we've been told, maybe this is a little bit early from some of the teams. You know, as I say, just trying something different on the strategy to make things, sometimes you have to go against the tide in strategy just to make something work, especially in endurance racing, whether that's a risk or not. You know, sometimes you just have to try for something. It's all McLaren's. That's a very good point. There's a couple of BMWs in the background, but there's been a number of McLaren's entered the pit lane this time round. So, possibly say something about the fuel in those.
Yeah, New World Subsport car, he was stuck behind Trendle, so decided to take a pit stop, and yeah, we've got a couple of BMWs behind him as well. Who is that? That's the Pro Racing Team number 3 in. Ham Endurance Team, Luis Rodriguez in. David Martinez of Cracks Racing Team in. But plenty of other McLaren staying out as well.
Yeah, We've just been told that there's been a switch between the Core Motorsports and the Inex Racing Blue. I do not believe that was a slowdown from Core Motorsports. I think that was just a legitimate overtake just based on the Sector 1 time. So it just seems like a legitimate overtake from the Inex Racing Blue car there to move themselves into what currently is P5. Obviously, at least one car stopped ahead. I think maybe a couple did ahead of this position. So it could be about for like 6th or 7th. Yep. There's also, I think, another team. I think it was Devon too, because I see the 4GT has dropped well off the timing for me, which means it has entered the pit lane and actually had a driver swap as well. So I think they might be the first with a driver swap. Is Glacier Racing. Oh, Redline as well, yeah.
It's Core Motorsports that comes into the pit lane, yes. Yeah, so just taking a look at the Redline team. They have swapped out Enzo Benito, who had taken the first stint, and they have switched him out for
Alexi Husi Yokola. So that's, I believe that's who I'm seeing in that car at the moment.
Indeed, yes, you're correct.
Which is not bad. It's just going to. We just have to wait and see how this strategy is going to work out for them, you know, and just see. I'm actually the Core Motorsports car. If anything, if I recall correctly, this was going back to Road America, where they actually pushed their stops a little bit further. They seem actually really, really quite good on their strategy. As here now, we're seeing basically everyone in the top lot.
Yeah,
the
remaining
pit lane, except some of the roofs. Yeah, yeah. We're seeing a lot of people entering this pit lane. Look at how busy that is. So this could be the defining moment of the first hour, right here.
I just had a car off, I didn't see who that was. It might have teleported to the pits.
Alright, so as we see at the moment, we've got about 6 cars. Well, we've got a few more outside of that, but we've got basically the top 5 that I can see at the moment. They definitely haven't stopped. The biggest one of that, of course, being the GT Ross SST Silver car, who's the what looked at this present moment in time the biggest challenger to Enzo Benito in that Team Redline car. So we're just. I'm wondering what they're playing with strategy, because this. It could cost them, you know, not being on fresh tyres and the like, but we'll have to wait and see how this plays out for them. But I would suspect we will see that car into the pit lane within at the end of this lap, at the end of the next lap, as the Inex Racing blue car enters the pit lane.
GT Ross.
As does the GT Ross.
Yes. That car is now in. So yeah, most. A lot of the cars who have been at the front are now all pitted. Just a quick one as we watch these pit stops shake out. Thanks to Blue Flag Racing for their support of this race. They'll be awarding prize money to the top 3. £75 for first, £50 for second, £25 for third. Nice bit of beer money there. So thanks very much, Blue Flag, for your support of the Massive Insurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps.
Indeed, it's nice to have the support that this series has had from the community and, of course, the sponsors. And so it's really nice to have a series that is so popular, that has so many drivers, so many teams, and you know, just a really solid following at the moment, especially considering this is only the third round in iRacing that we currently have, as a few of the cars are a bit further back now entering the pit lane. I believe after this lap basically everyone would have stopped.
Yeah, once everyone's done, we can finally see how it's shaking out. Yeah, a few cars in the pit, so it will take a few more seconds to work out exactly where everyone has ended up. The combination of live timing and iRacing itself is it's a bit of a challenge to actually work out who's where.
Yeah, it looks like I see Redline Car has got a bit more of a gap from if my live timing is updated at the correct point. The GT Ross SST Silver Car has actually dropped further back, as you can actually see that on your screen right now. Has dropped further back into the clutches of Van Seesport Car, the number 18. There's really not much between those two, possibly just under a second. But there is 13.8 seconds between this car and the leader, so that Team Redline Car has pulled out quite a substantial gap.
Yeah, that's a good round of pit stops for them. Their fastest lap of the race is still much faster than anyone else's fastest lap, which isn't sure says a lot, I think. If you just have a little look back in the field, P22 is car number 3, Stadler, who was in that action before all the pit stops, is being chased once again by Antti Bjarhag. Just can't get away from him. They're just coming now into Bouchelle, that right-handed hairpin. That new World Team Sport McLaren chasing hard in P23, but obviously they will go up the order once all the pit stops have settled down, I think. Or have they lost? I think maybe they lost the position in the pit stops, actually.
Yeah, we've just been informed as well of another team with a drive-through penalty. It's the car 84 Hellenic Racing with an incident with LLM at the chicane on lap 19 there. Down quite a way, I believe that's in 38th position, so that's probably going to hurt them quite a bit.
That was, collision with last lap Motorsports car 52, who started the race in 58th position. Last lap Motorsports now, Derek Murray on board in 28th in their roof.
Oh. Yeah, we've just been told that Glacier Racing car, the one that we've been keeping our eye on, I think the last time we saw it was in 6th or 7th, has moved its way up into the 5th spot. I don't know what happened to who was in 6th, who was in 5th rather, the last time I saw. Maybe they actually stopped. Also, I see the GT Ross SST Silver car has actually dropped back into 3rd place. At some point recently. It does look like it was probably a slowdown for that car as the Corona Simsport is quite a way round. But there was a fairly important change right there, which means the Corona Simsport car might be able to go after the Team Redline. We don't really know, it's a bit early to tell in this stint, but either way, a mistake there from the GT Ross SST Silver car, and based on everything, I think that's the second slowdown they've got so far in this event.
Just another note that once again, IQP manager also supporting this round of the championship, and later on we'll be giving you the opportunity to use one of 24 codes to receive a whole year of IQP, including the 2D viewer aspect of the game. So that's worth a fair bit of money. If you like a bit of race management gaming, we'll be letting you know about that a little later on. So thank you very much to IGP Manager for their support with the Haas Endurance Series. I'll just give you a quick rundown of the positions after the pit stops. Team Redline leads the race by 15 seconds, followed by Coanda Simsport, GT Ross SST Silver in 3rd, Inex Racing Red in 4th, 5th is Glacier Racing, 6th Core Motorsports, 7th Vortex Sim Racing, 8th Team TTL, 9th Inex Racing Blue, and 10th America Racing Team, who are 38 and a half seconds behind the leader, which is Alexei Usi-Jakola in the Team Redline car.
Yeah, he's not exactly putting in slow lap times at the moment. 2:18.8 is actually is a pretty good time. It's not faster than the top five, but a good time nonetheless. The fastest time off that top five is the car that is the GT Ross SST silver car under pressure.
We're just
getting close.
Yeah, there's a battle going on between car 20 Vortex Sim Racing and Core Motorsports car 33. In fact, there was a change of position as Guez in the Vortex Sim Racing car took sixth place from Niels Koch through Lecune. Meanwhile, you are watching. The 113 car. Indeed, you are. Yes, you're watching the GT Ross SST Silver P3, being followed closely by Inex Racing Red Jake Sturgis, car 99. But this is a battle for third. BMW, that red BMW is Inex Racing, the orange and silver GT Ross SST Silver car is the roof in front.
Yeah, it looks like it's under heavy fire at the moment, and possibly a move looking to boil down. Oh, it's looking like he's going to have a little go earlier than that, but down at the bus stop chicane is actually diving through now for Blanchemont, going too wide. This is going to be scary. Just give some position. Smart move. Smart move this early on. So there we go, we've got the NX Racing Red car moving up into the third position. So it's McLaren, BMW, Roof, 4GT, all four makes in the top five.
Next on Sturgis' shopping list will be Andre Kutcher in P2, the Klander SimSport team.
Looking fast enough to take it as well at the moment. Is that the next racing the red car of Jake Sturgios? And he's going pretty fast. He's doing times faster than the top two. I also confused as to why the Team Redline car just did a 2:20.2. That is quite a slow lap time for those at the moment, especially considering he did do an 18.8. Maybe just getting a feel for the car again, and maybe making a slight mistake in the second and third sectors based on the timing, but whatever. Jake Sturgis is looking pretty damn quick.
I think he was held BMW up by a back marker.
That could also be reason.
Yeah, I think he was held up by just CTC Racing at the coming down the hill. He got stuck, and that's what's lost him those few seconds.
We've just been told that the number 91 has had to give up effectively three positions because of one slowdown. So that's showing that these slowdowns are they're pretty nasty and they're very easy to get. So sometimes maybe running the risk sometimes just isn't worth it.
Yeah, indeed. And that's Dylan Sharman in the Team TTL car. He just was going through the shell after having taken that slowdown. Got a big sideways moment you saw on screen. Lost a little bit of time, so he just needs to probably maybe overdriving just a little bit after that frustrating slowdown. And yeah, Iberica Racing team and Pure Racing both got past. And we've had an accident. Car 114 at the exit of Blanchimont has got big rear end damage and is just pulling into the bus stop chicane now. You can see him on screen. I'm not sure what happened. I'm going to have a little look. He was a mistake. He lost it halfway through the corner, spun around, and then had heavy rear-end contact with the wall. No one hit him, luckily. But they were down in 47th position, and no doubt lose a few more positions as they, I think, look to repair the damage. No, they didn't. They didn't come into the pit, so maybe the damage isn't bad enough. So, battle for P19. David Martinez of Trax Racing Team just got past the Ham Endurance car, you can see on screen. And behind them is Ben Tustin of Team Camara, looking to take both of them. He's a driver with pace, that Ben Tustin. And in fact, he's looking at the inside into the bus stop, but doesn't make the move. You can see there, him just on the inside line. Behind them is Miguel Nieto of AB Racing Black in the roof. So there's a four-car battle for P18 going on right now.
Yeah, Ben Tustin hopping into that car, the Team Camaro 2 car, the 54, which We did see running close towards the top 10 earlier, and has now dropped back quite a quite substantial way, now running just outside the top 20. Whether I'm... Ooh. Absolutely true, we've got a battle going on for 4 seconds. Wow, that is a very close battle right there, as they're all getting held up by a back marker, as such a team red line car did do it in 21 on the previous lap, so once again being held up by back markers, as this lot are as well, as this is getting very, very close indeed.
Yeah, it's Team Camara, Inex Racing Red, and GT Ross SST Silver all making their way past Helmut Racing Team. Nestoros behind the wheel of that car in 54th position, getting out of the way in good order, but it's a very close battle now for that P2, as, yes, as you say, the lead red line car of Uusi Jäkelä did have a very slow last lap, but again, that's probably because there's a lot of backmarkers now around the track. You're going to have to expect that.
Yeah, it's going to get even harder and harder through those good lap times. It's all going to be a bit of luck as to when you catch people, really, because as much as like this whole one make, everyone's doing a GT car. It's not like in the World Sports Car Series and things like that, where you're catching someone who's in a roof whilst you're in a HPD coming up over Eau Rouge. Those things don't really have those different running roughly the same pace. But yeah, even then, backmarkers are going to become quite a big thing from now on, where they're actually going to be kind of hard to navigate because everyone's in the same vehicles roughly. They sometimes might actually be quite difficult for them to get out of the way, because you're just not quick enough to just fly past them, and they don't really want to give up too many seconds.
Yeah, indeed. And they're just coming up now on that damaged car 114 that had the accident at Blanchimont a couple of laps ago. Commander SimSport were the first one to navigate its way past that damaged McLaren, but luckily gets out of the way. Sturgis in its racing red, though, probably 3 or 4 car lengths behind into Bouchel. And yes, De La Fuente in the GT Ross SST Silver waiting behind.
Indeed, this lot very close still, but no changes as of this moment. They're all fairly racy though, and all very quick.
Yeah, definitely this is a significant battle. I mean, you might think maybe they want to help each other out and try and chop back some of that 13.5-second gap that Alexei Uusi Jäkelä has in the Team Redline car, but really it's every man for himself. These three teams not affiliated one with another, and going at it like proper races. And De La Fuente in the GT Ross car has just fallen behind a little bit. I think Jake Sturgis is lining himself up for a pass on Butcher. They come through the fast left-hander at the exit of Blanchimont, and he might have a little look into the bus stop, but Butcher defends and brakes nice and late and stays ahead. Now riding on board with Samuel De La Fuente as he heads up through Eau Rouge. Those two cars ahead of him battling it out, but he is waiting patiently for an opportunity. And in fact, Jake Sturgis in that Inex Racing red car, now in the slipstream of Butcher, goes to the inside and looks to be lining up for that P2 pass, but Butcher brakes late, stays on the outside, but he doesn't quite have the line to keep it. In fact, he's almost lost the position there from De La Fuente, but Fuente made a mistake. You were riding on board with that. He possibly put the throttle down a little too early in his anticipation of getting past the Coanda SimSport BMW, but in the end, he stayed fourth. But that doesn't change for second now. Jake Sturgis, Inex Racing Red, takes P2. 1 hour and 23 minutes into the race. Still over 22 hours to go.
Yeah, I would be too surprised if we saw Jake Sturgis just based on his pace when catching these two. To see him not easily, but, you know, just maybe, you know, pull a gap to these two. But it looked like De La Fuente was just playing it calm, you know, not trying to make the situation overcrowded, not trying to overcomplicate everything, you know, because he could have quite easily thrown it down the inside of the Nico Anderson sport car there, but just decided that risk for that one versus reward just isn't high enough. It's just easier to keep the cards close to your chest at the moment and just play a nice simple game.
As you can see, there really was quite the old pace deficit there between the NX and the Coanda cars. Jake Sturgis pulling away from Andre Bocci quite quickly at the moment, and again, as you see under braking, the roof very strong. So Bocci are under a lot of pressure at this stage in the race.
So taking a look now at Glacier Racing. In a moment, and there they are, coming through Eau Rouge.
Yeah, it looks like this Glacier Racing is having a pretty substantial role reversal at the moment. You know, the first stint of the race, it was working its way through the order, and now it's having to keep its eye quite firmly on that rear view mirror and, you know, play the defensive game from quite a number of these drivers, as he has got three very close, and even then you've got Pablo Lopez, who's only 3 and a bit seconds down the road, who I do believe is running about a second faster lap, so they could join this train before the end of this stint. So, yeah, that Garcia Racing, definitely a role reversal.
So we had a tweet earlier, I think, from the man currently behind the wheel of that Glacier Racing car, Yari Lokhtari. He said, beyond me and the other driver, we have no idea who else is going to be driving. So they're sort of, I think they're racing stint by stint, the Glacier Racing team.
It'd be lovely if we saw the likes of Riku Alatalo get into the car, or as he's affectionately known, Riku Tuli.
Sounds very affectionate.
Getting close towards the front as the 113 car is looking for a move in the 18. The roof on the BMW going down into Lesource is going to definitely have a look. I think he might try and throw one down the inside. There's a slight dive bomb for Eau Rouge as off we go into Lesource. Nice. Oh, trying to cut back from the Coanda car, but never quite working. However, there was a position change for third place. The GT Ross SST Silver car, which was running second for the first in the race, now back into third after a, I think what we saw was a fairly poor pit stop and not a great start to the second stint.
Well, they had a bit of a cut over the exit of Eau Rouge. I'm not sure if that will result in a slowdown. Looks like they're okay. They ran wide as well, got away with it.
I think you can get away with quite a bit of murder on the exit at the moment. It's just over the top where it really punishes you for doing stuff wrong.
So there's all sorts of action going on the screen there. We've got the cars going three wide. It was a bit lappy going. It's racing blue, also overtaking Cormos, was 33 for 7th position. Meanwhile, the Glacier Racing.
Oh my goodness! The Coanda car has been taken out by a bat marker. That Samuel De La Fuente barely avoided a huge damage from Andre Bocci. And I can't see who that was who caused the incident there. I can't find the car's number at all. It was a BMW running back in the pack.
Yeah, so we're just going to see a replay of that now, I believe.
Yeah. They came through the shell. What happened?
Ooh. Oh, wow. No. Yeah, that was really, really poor. Wow.
Well, whoever that was, we'll have to find out.
Car 93, Ring Pond Racing, we've been told.
Broadside in the middle of the track reversed. So unfortunate. Kinda were doing so well.
Yeah, I think most drivers have been on the receiving end of someone sort of sitting on the middle of the racetrack not really knowing what to do. It was just...
Heck, De La Fuente barely missed it.
That's such a shame. That is such a shame. Yeah, now they've got to live with that for 20 hours, 20, 22 and a bit hours. So they may actually still have a fast repair, so it might
straight
actually,
to the pit lane.
They might be okay, but yeah, obviously just going to dump it straight in the pit, and there is a lot of damage to that car. That is such a shame, though.
Yeah. To be honest, they're very lucky that the engine didn't go, because looking at Jose Arriaza of the Rincon Racing car caused that incident, he looks to have severe engine problems, and that could very well be a DNF.
Just gone back to the SL mode. Butcher saw what was happening. He slowed it down to about 58 miles an hour before the impact. So I think that braking probably saved him from blowing the engine. Otherwise, he would have hit at much higher speed. Because often you try and get past this incident by speeding up, by hoping that you'll get past before the guy moves. But this time, Butcher was sensible and braked pretty much as hard as he possibly could before the impact.
Yeah. Crying shame, though.
Yeah, absolutely.
Really were running a good race.
Yeah, indeed. And Coanda are in fifth in the championship, having won the first race of the season, and have a troublesome time at Suzuka, and it looks again that luck has not gone their way here at Spa. So the kind of SimSport car is back out of the pits. All the bits and pieces that have fallen off are now back on. So it looks like that was a fresh repair. It didn't take a huge amount of time either. So they should, if the pace stays up, they should be able to recover some of their lost time. But that's still not ideal, because it was exactly halfway through their stint. So it's really put them out of kilter for the rest of the race. And it's Jorn Jens now who's at the wheel of the car. So they have done a driver swap too.
I think having a driver swap after an incident like that, honestly, is the best thing to do, because it's quite easy for a driver to lose their head and, you know, either push too hard or make a mistake or you know, like that. It's just better to get that driver out of the car and let him have a cool down period, as we've got some battling going on behind the Glacier Racing car.
You'll find that over the next 12 hours, if they can run 1 hour, 5 minute stints, they'll actually completely remove the deficit or the lack of continuity that they've given themselves in terms of pit stop strategy to the rest of the field.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you're currently riding on board the Glacier Racing car of Lotari. He's got Robin Friskops in its racing blue behind. He's got Joel Guez behind that. And then Niels Koch in the Core Motorsports car and Pablo Lopez and Berica all behind. So that's a battle from fourth down to ninth, eighth. I know numbers. And it looks like Friskops is going to possibly have a go, but that Ford GT is very quick in a straight line, so he'll struggle to go around the outside into Le Coombe, but he's doing it anyway. I don't think he's going to make it. I'll eat my words. He has made it, and he's side by side through the exit, but now into Bruchel, he might struggle. In fact, no, he's made the pass before Bruchel, and now the Glacier Racing car losing another position, this time from the Vortex Sim Racing car, round the outside of Bruchel.
One starts a lot.
You're watching from the rear of that NX Racing car, and yes, there's the Vortex car is now, that Vortex McLaren is now ahead, and Glacier Racing is possibly going to lose another position from the Core Motorsports 33 car,
again. And Koch.
So, an hour and a half into the race, we say goodbye temporarily for to Oscar Hardwick and Lewis Beglade, who are off to go race something.
I'm off to team manage.
I'm off to race something that he's not team managing. So, okay.
Separate
completely event. Different things at the same time in the evening.
Excellent. Well, good luck in your respective outings, and we'll see you later.
Indeed, good day. Good luck.
See you later on, and hopefully the next few hours of the race can go on without incidents for the front guys.
Yeah, I hope so. And replacing those two will be admin, cameraman, and general extraordinary gentleman, Phil Diaz.
Hello?
I don't know why I called him extraordinary gentleman. That was strange.
Yeah, that was completely inaccurate.
Niels Koch nearly gets harpooned by Pablo Lopez in the Oberica car as they head through. Oh, there's contact between the two of them. In fact, it looks like Niels Koch remains ahead in seventh position in the Core Motorsports car. Pablo Lopez is back behind in the Oberica racing team, but is now looking for a pass. You're riding on board with the Core Motorsports car, being passed there by two. Contact again, though. Stefan Mujica in the Virgil racing car also took a position from him and finds himself now down in ninth position, does the that Core Motorsports car. So a lot of positions lost in the space of the car.
Yeah, I'd say he just got bullied there by a couple cars. Yeah, got the short end of the stick for sure.
Yeah, he got shoveled off twice, so not really his fault. And now the Virgil racing car now looking for a pass for seventh going into Le Coum, but I don't think he's quite got the brakes for it. Pablo Lopez in the Iberica car breaks very late indeed, but remains ahead. So there's been some talk about corner cutting and how that's penalised. Can you just explain exactly what the mechanism is that keeps an eye on corner cutting and black flags and all that kind of stuff?
Sure. So what it is, I've created this software, I guess you could say, and all it does is it checks for specific corners, both left side and right side of the track, and just wherever I set it to, and it checks different sectors. And the main thing is sectors where teams could potentially gain time. So the exit of Washamon, for example, they could run wide and theoretically gain time on the field. Obviously, we see that as unfair. I'm pretty sure almost every other team sees that unfair. And therefore, you know, we've created software to prevent that. So what it is, or what we have it set at currently, is if a team goes over five off tracks in a certain sector in a 15-lap period, then they initially get a warning, and then they would, if they do it again, they get a penalty. Now, we have seen things of lag and stuff like that. We actually excluded Eau Rouge from this software simply because we realized that could be happening, the lag that is. So, you know, we check corners where, like Blanchimont, for example, you're always turning left. There should be no lag to where they go off to the right, where the server believes that, at least. So we also, you know, review it to make sure that if cars, you know, have an oversteer moment or if they spun off track or something like that, that they're not wrongly penalized for it.
Cool. Well, hopefully that clears things up. You guys have got it covered, which is good. It's good there are three of you working on that at the moment.
Yeah, we have Michael Booth and also Jonathan Palmer who are looking at that. We also have a couple other people that are helping just basically review. If someone goes off track, then you know, you got to review to make sure. We have the lap numbers that they went off track, so therefore it's easy to find out if they actually did it or not. So you just have to review it, make sure it's not wrongly accused.
So you can see on the screen, the head of this chain of cars is the Glacier Racing 4GT. Just had a nudge the rear from the Iberica Racing car of Pablo Lopez in 7th. And I think that Iberica car really would like to get past. He's been looking very racy for the last lap or so, and I think we could be looking at a pass before this lap is over as they now head down through Goa.
Yeah, hopefully there's no NASCARing out of the way. It's what do you think of like a bump and run? I know the Glacier guys do a lot of NASCARing, and I think Pablo Lopez does too, actually. Could be a nice little joke in between them. I know Alexi Aloma said, is this NASCAR earlier? So Pablo with a late dive there.
That's very good indeed, yeah, through through Stavelo. Oh, and behind them, the Virgil Racing car also having a look. They're side by side, Pablo Lopez and Yo Lotari, but Lopez stays behind as Lotari had a better run out of Stavelo. And now into Blanchimont, they're all line astern. Lotari a little bit wide on entry, exit through the corner, but will Lopez go for a late lunge? Yes, Lotari stays out of the way, but will he get the inside from the second element of the bus stop? Yes, he does, and he might get back ahead. No, but it's a better exit for Lopez, who stays on the outside, has a bit more traction, and is now ahead into sixth position. Meanwhile, Virgin Racing, Vigelaar remains in eighth, as the two cars ahead of him almost make contact into the source, and probably unwise for Lotari to be so aggressive. Probably could have braked a bit earlier and just tucked him behind, and now he's put himself in a bit of pressure from that Virtual Racing car, that roof, that yellow roof. And then behind them all is Niels Koch in the Core Motorsports 33 car, who's looking and enjoying this, I imagine.
Yeah, I'm hoping they know that it hasn't even reached the 2 hour mark, which isn't even one third of our shortest race, 6 hour races. So maybe they stay a little calm here at 24 hour race.
Yeah, and Lotari now drafts his way back past the Iberica car, and he will have the inside of the second element of the. Of Lecoum, and I think there was possibly some contact there, and now he's going to possibly use his place from Virgil Racing, but no, it's ahead, but he can head into Bruchel. If the Virgil Racing car is down the inside, he could have a chance. In fact, yeah, Vigelaar is on the inside, still on the inside, and he will have the outside line for the next corner though, but I think he's just about managed to take that position. Yes, he takes seventh from Virgil Racing, but then runs a bit wide, and it's not over yet as they head down to Puan. I think Glacier now struggling a little bit with the dirty air as they went through Puan and now head up to Panier.
Yeah, I think we have to remember that 4GT theoretically is the slowest car, and some are saying that the roof is the quickest car. So Yari's doing a great job right now holding his own against these other cars here around him.
Yeah, next up is Niels Koch, as you can see that purple and yellow roof. Currently in ninth. I'll give you a quick rundown of positions after 1 hour and 40 minutes of this race. Team Redline leads by 9.2 seconds. That lead is smaller than it was 10 laps ago. InX Racing Red in second, third, GT Ross, SST Silver, fourth, InX Racing Blue, fifth, Vortex Sim Racing, sixth, Iberica Racing Team, seventh, Virgil Racing, who you just saw make a couple of positions, eighth, Glacier Racing, who's defending from Core Motorsports in ninth, Radicals Online Car 2 in 10th, Team CTL 11th, 12th is GT Ross Orange, 13th is New World SimSport, 14th is JCL, and 15th is Star Racing Team. And yeah, it's been really quite action-packed up in the top 15 today, and well, I think there's plenty more to come. These guys really they're on similar pace, and you know, after each set of pit stops, everything gets reset. And I think Glacier Racing just had a bit of a moment coming out of Eau Rouge, actually, and lost a little bit of time.
Looks like they're safe, actually, to the Core Motorsports car. Just looking around for other battles on the track. There's cars within about half second to a second of each other, but nothing, you know, side-by-side action. Looking up at second and third position. The GT Ross, I already forgot, is this silver or orange?
Which one are you looking at?
113.
Yeah,
sorry
GT
guys,
Ross,
let
silver.
Me actually get live timing open. Yeah, it's silver, but currently on the back of NX Racing Red. Jake Sturgis driving that car. Second position.
Yeah, it's a good battle for second and third, that one. Looking at the most recent lap times of those two, in fact, it was Nick Racing Red who was slightly faster on the previous lap.
And also want to note that, I'll just flip to Jake here so you guys can see the split to Team Redline. 8.5 seconds. It's a huge gain so far this stint, NX Racing Red on Team Redline.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, it started out at about 17 seconds. It was about 13 seconds 10 laps ago, and now it's under 9 seconds. So yeah, that's some great laps from Jake Sturgis. The previous lap, he was about 0.6 of a second quicker than Alexei Uciakala.
Yeah, if I just saw that correctly, Jake had a 19.426 the lap before, and then now he's at a 19.428, so very consistent, 0.02 of a second apart. And Team Redline, they're consistent, but just a little bit slower. We've noted that, you know, Enzo's probably the quickest driver when it comes to the McLaren and Team Redline. So, you know, just how it has to be. I think Jake's probably the fastest driver for NX Racing Red as well. So this is a good thing here, I believe.
Looking back a bit further, the NX Racing Blue Car 8 and the Vortex Racing 20 car, they're in 4th and 5th. And sort of within, well, they can see each other. On previous lap, their lap time was, the Vortex and Racing car in 5th was about 0.4 faster than the NX Racing car of Friscott's. So that could be a battle joined very soon, as you see them going through Les Cunes.
Yeah, I also want to note that you can see the Vortex and Racing car, they have a draft. And that draft, while it doesn't seem to be that big of a deal, can gain you a lot of time. So you can see Jolgez slowly gaining on Robin Friscott's in NX Racing Blue. I believe it's just mainly him staying up with the use of draft, which is a good thing. He's saving fuel, saving his tires. But I think we'll see a lot of drivers kind of staying within that half second range just to kind of just get the draft and just stay where they are, mainly not trying to make a move on anyone.
Pretty sensible. Speaking of sensible, there was a bit of unsensible driving earlier in the race, and it was car 93. You saw that collision with Coanda that's cost him an awful lot of time, and Rincon Racing, who caused that broadside in the middle of the road, have been given, or will be given, a two-lap penalty. It's not been applied yet, but it will be applied soon. So a two-lap penalty for car 93 for that incident.
Yeah, it sounds harsh, but honestly, I'm pretty sure everyone who watched the replay on stream there saw it. It was it wasn't the best thing you've watched in a while, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's probably, we've not seen any, we've seen lots of close calls with cars broadside like that over this season, but nothing quite that bad and significant for a car that was, you know, in the running for a win.
Yeah, I don't know. We saw Coanda have an issue last race with a back marker, but that was just simply the back marker lost it in a hairpin, and it was like a 20-mile-an-hour impact.
Yeah.
And it wasn't any, you know, it wasn't anything huge. This was just someone who had just had an accident, and, you know, your adrenaline's running high, and it seems like he just simply made a mistake. But, I mean, that mistake's going to give you a pretty hefty penalty. Not just because you took out someone who was running up front, but just because, you know, you took out someone when, well, trying to recover your car in an unsafe manner.
Indeed. Just taking a look at the hashtag IRMOE on Twitter. If you want to get in touch, go ahead. Cormac Sports saying that a good job from Alex Voss there, and Team Camara saying that this is their first 24-hour race and there's still a long way to go. Yeah, definitely true there. And Blue Thread Racing, the sponsor of this event, reminding drivers that you should use the F3 menu to see when cars are nearby if you're broadside in the middle of the road. Sound advice there, I think.
Yeah, from Blue Flag Racing of all people. Blue Flag, I mean, it just sounds perfect, really.
Yeah, they got that one right. So let's take a look. I think the closest battle now is the battle for 8th between car 33 for Motorsports and Yari Lotari in the 4GT Glacier Racing car 41. We're looking at Core Motorsports. As they...
I'm sorry, I was going to say, I think Core Motorsports is going to be one of those people. Some of the drivers have actually been around Masters of Endurance since the Live for Speed days, and I believe that they're going to be one of those teams that are going to be really quiet. We'll probably see them in the top 5 by the end of this race, simply because, you know, that these type of races, of course you want the pace and everything to be, you know, up there up front, but you also have to be very consistent. You can't make any mistakes, and this team has finished 4th in the first 2 races of the season, and literally do it in the most quiet ways possible. We hardly even know they're racing most of the time.
Yeah, indeed. You know, a top 5 position in this race is worth more than a win in one of the standard races in terms of points, because points double. So if you finish fifth, you earn 152 points, where a win in a normal race was 100. So yeah, any good finish here could really change the course of the championship.
Exactly, and that's also huge for Coanda, who got sent back because of that accident. And I believe they're not too far back right now. I actually have a look at them to see where they are. 23rd position.
Yeah, 23rd. Currently lapping pretty quickly as well.
Yes, and the car in front of them is R4R Motorsports. That is Scott Michaels.
So yes, they're just on the way out of the bus stop, looking for a pass for 22nd for Jorn Jens, who took over that Coanda car after the accident.
I think the main thing here is simply they used up one of their fast tows. I believe they're going to have another one, unless the first pit stop used it. I really hope it didn't. But yeah, it's just they have one extra pit stop to do now, because I don't believe they can go hour 5 minute stints. So you have one more pit stop to do now, and you just gotta keep chugging, I guess. Hope everything kind of rolls your way here. They have the pace to do it. They have the pace to easily get back into the top 10, even top 5. It's a 24-hour race after all.
And that's a late-breaking move. Passes Scott Michaels, who doesn't force the issue. That's now, 22nd place for Coanda SimSport. I mean, the one hope they can have is that, you know, they've got their bad luck out of the way early, and it is likely that other cars in the top 10 will also have big problems. It's just inevitable in a race this long. You can't have... Well, having a trouble-free race is, unlikely. It just depends how severe the problem you have is, really. Like, it could be a minor bit of contact, it could be getting blocked, it could be having your own mistake. It just so happened that Coanda had pretty much the worst possible thing that could happen.
Yeah, and as Oscar pointed out before, at least their engine did not blow. Because if that happened, then, who knows if they even would have been able to get a fresh car, so...
You're looking at Glacier Racing, trying to take P7, and there's a little bit of contact between them and the Iberica Racing Team car. And round the outside goes Jari Lotari. I wonder if he'll be able to do that. There was contact that allowed him to do that overtake. It was minor contact, to be fair. But he takes P7 for now from the Iberica Racing car of Pablo Lopez, who sticks around the outside through La Source and will get a great run on the exit and may be side by side going into Eau Rouge.
I really hope not. I really, really hope not.
Bit of a Weber Alonso situation going on.
Yeah.
Oh, Lotari just tucks in front. And wanting to get a good line through Eau Rouge, but actually nearly loses it on the exit.
Yeah.
Bit of sideways, and he will definitely be giving some slipstream to Lopez there.
Yeah, the compression is a huge deal when entering Eau Rouge, but then also you come up over that crest and the car gets light. I drove a few laps in the Ford, and I could really experience that for sure. The car getting light over the crest, so you probably just saw that there on stream. Just want to note also that the 33 and the 35 Core Motorsports and Radicals Online 2 are for position back there.
Yeah, indeed. So that's a four-way battle now you're watching, which is very good stuff. So yeah, it's 7th, 8th, 9th and 10th, Glacier, Iberica, Core and Radicals Online. Nearly making contact with Core at the rear of that shot. I'm not sure if you saw that.
Yeah, it looked like, it all started with Iberica Racing. They got really sideways.
Ooh, yeah.
And it's weird, actually. Pablo Lopez asked, because each car, if they're going through Eau Rouge right now, and we look to see, each car, they're saying that, we didn't cut, but we're getting a black flag, and we review that. And if we can see that the car actually did cut, then, we're not going to go and clear your black flag. And Pablo just... message saying, can you please clear the black flag? But you did cut the course. That's nothing we can do there. You have to slow down.
Yeah, so is there currently a black flag on car 10 at the moment?
I believe so. Unless he did slow down. I mean, he dropped way back from the number 2 cars who he was near. And yes, he is pitting right now. So I believe there was a penalty set up for them.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a protest, I think, from his spotter saying that he didn't cut, but, well, the replay has been reviewed, and it looks like he did, so that is a drive through.
Yeah, well, I believe what ends up happening, iRacing takes control of this. We don't take control of it. And now Pablo's typed in driver chat, which is not allowed. Simply, I believe what iRacing does is when you get the track and then you don't serve it, you get like a 17-second stop and hold penalty. So,
ouch. That's not good.
Yeah, so it's kind of silly to even risk it. You think you would just slow down. Yeah.
So that's given the Glacier Racing a bit of room to breathe, but now it's car 35, Paul Liebrink, Radicals Online 2, challenging their Core Motorsports 33 car into Rochelle.
I'm going to go on board here with Radicals Online 2, Paul Liebrink.
Running a little bit wide, that core car, but didn't lose too much time. I think it was just an alternative line. I think Paul Liebrink is taking it nice and easy.
Yeah, actually running wide there, all the way up to the curb, we're checking that for any form of, you know, off tracks and whatnot, but running wide like that actually really isn't faster. So most of those that we check are probably just end up going to get ignored. You won't really get a penalty for that because you're not gaining time. But we're checking that whole entire corner, so we can see, you know, if someone goes flat out and then runs wide and just keeps flat out, you know, it's, that'd be obvious then.
So they head into Rochimon. It's very close indeed. Will Paul Liebrink go for a pass? And he's been pretty calmly following and not been pressuring too hard. I think just biding his time, not going for the aggressive moves. Probably a sensible way of driving. And as they head out of the chicane, yeah, he's a little way behind now in ninth.
Yeah, Paul's really patient. He actually does quite a bit of endurance racing. I know he races in Neo as well, in the HPD. So yeah, he knows, you know, how to endurance race. He knows how to be patient, which is always good.
The lead is down to 7.5 seconds. Slowly but surely, Jake Stogios is making time, but I think we'll have got to the end of this stint by the time he's anywhere near.
Yeah, and I think also what we're seeing is the GT Ross car staying right behind Jake and an X Racing Red, and they're basically just both gaining on Team Redline for the lead, closing all three cars up. Actually going to stay on board but move to a different car here. New World Sim Sport, currently right behind Team TTL.
It's car 44. That's Antti Piala, who, yes, is pressuring Team TTL for 10th. They're both McLarens. And heading into the downhill part of the track through Fagnier and then down to Stabilo.
Yeah, great job by both these teams here. Currently, well, New World Sim Sport in 11th position. I was going to say both in the top 10, but close enough to it, to be honest.
Yeah, dude, they've been there or thereabouts the whole race, really. Quite an action-packed race for New World Sim Sport. Lots of fun moments for them. And now they're just following, but not passing, the Team TTL car. Previous lap was about less than a tenth of a second quicker than the TTL car. And behind them is JTL Sim Racing, Sylvain Pommelard, who was in the middle of the action earlier in the race, still there in 12th. Glacier Racing in the pit lane.
Yes, I was just about to note that Glacier Racing is in the pit lane with their 4GT.
One of the first teams to stop this round. Richard Dennis and the Falcon GP car has also been in, but I think Glacier are the first front running team, top 10 team, to make a pit stop.
Now we have Radicals Online 2 right on the back of Core Motorsports. Core Motorsports does not have the Glacier Racing draft anymore.
Indeed, yeah, side by side going into Lake Hume, and that is a pass for position, P7 for Paul Ulbrink in the Radicals Online car.
Just behind that, we also see New World Simsport going around Team TTL, maybe? Dylan Charman does not want to give that up, but he has to.
Yep, side by side all the way through Lake Hume, but in the end, yeah, they had to go to New World Simsport, who have now got, I think, 9th position. And that core Radicals battle isn't over yet. Lewis Koch in that core car is still just behind the Radicals car, but you're still looking at this this McLaren battle, and now that, yep, you're now looking back at this roof.
Yeah, they're coming up on that.
That's fine, I was being silly, should be looking at the stream. And yeah, so and the next car they have to come up against is the 25 car of Patrice Langley of Monster Energy Endurance in P48. They're going to have to get around him somehow, unless they decide to pit in this lap. We're just heading up to the 2 hour mark. 1 hour and 59.
Well, I believe the iRacing clock's a little wrong. It's 4 minutes from hitting this second hour, the end of the second hour.
Oh, the iRacing clock includes the gridding time.
Exactly.
I must ignore it then, in that case.
Core Motorsports ran a little wide there in Blanchemont.
They're trying to get past this Monster Energy car. Radicals are the first to encounter it. He slows down, so politely lets them in through. Well, poor car had to go very wide indeed through the source. That did not work out well at all.
Yeah, you don't want to run that wide. That turf is like ice.
Yeah, he lost a lot of time, didn't lose position. The car that went past was Juan Pinho of AD Racing Silver, who was in 48th, so a lap or so down. But yeah, he lost a good 2 or 3 seconds because he was trying to take the outside and just ran over the ran out of braking space, I guess. A bit of a weird one.
It's definitely an odd situation there. Now, I don't know exactly what Team Redline's strategy is, but if I remember correctly, they pit on lap, I believe it was 25, wasn't it? The first time around?
Oh, we've had, yeah, just to interrupt you there. Car 79, the Phoenix Motorsports car, had an off on the exit of Blanchemont. I don't think anyone hit them, and they hadn't hit the wall either, so they continue to go. They're still going. But yeah, it's a scary spin there.
I think if you spin there and don't hit anything and definitely don't get hit by anybody, you've done a good job. To be honest, I think you've done a really good job. Also want to note that we see NX Racing Red slowly pulling away from the GT Rolls car. GT Rolls Silver to be exact. Number 113.
Yeah, previous lap was a third of a second quicker than the GT Rose car. That was in X Racing Red here. Yeah, you can see on screen there, coming down the straight.
I think NX Racing Red can barely see Team Redline down the Kimmel straight here right before. Right as they come along in the straight, I believe they can see him way ahead. So, you know, that's also a little bit of fuel to Jake's fire right now to try to catch up before, maybe even before these pit stops, because I believe Team Redline's going to pit at least one lap earlier. And therefore, that's, you know, that's huge because those tires mean everything. And that's also a strategy that Team Redline may be utilizing right now. They're pitting a lap or two earlier, and sure, they might have to do an extra pit stop, but maybe that lap of 2 seconds or so that they gain on that lap of fresh tires will help them.
Yeah, there's like 3 cars between the lead and second position. They are the GTRS Orange car, the KRT Motorsport 97, and the Flux Racing team that separate first and second place.
To note that Jorn Jens for Coanda Simsport pitching Mad Cow. Mad Cow Racing 2, to be exact. Craig Hunter at the wheel. Jorn still charging through the field, up into the top 20.
Yeah, but he's moved over to the right-hand side as Jorn Jens goes past, taking that P18.
I'll allow that one time.
I think we're allowed one cow pun per race. That was, yeah. And that's quite difficult in this one because it's so long, but we have to... we won't milk it too much. Oh, whoops. But that was fair enough. I think Craig Hunter saw that Kwanda Carl was quicker and, yeah, moved over to the right. It didn't make it too difficult. And Jorien's in 18th now. Speeding along. His previous lap. I think he might be in 16th. It's confusing. The live tracker and the iRacing are saying different things because we're getting the pit stop phase of the race now. So
exactly. Team Redline currently in the pits. NX Racing Red and GT Ross Silver still going. Also want to note that JCL Sim Racing trying to pass Dylan Sharman and Team TTL for the 9th position. And Dylan's actually pitting now, so Team TTL and Team Redline look like they're pretty much on the same strategy currently. I know it's extremely early in the race to say that, just wondering.
Yeah, imagine, I guess you go out of sync with each other. It'll get to the point where we're wondering, like, oh, we've got to wait for the final step to know where it all ends up.
It's always tough. I mean, even in 6-hour races, it's tough to figure out, how, you know, what's going on. We don't see their fuel, we don't see their tires, anything like that. So we pretty much are blind when it comes to information from the race team unless we talk to them directly. Kind of like a real race, I guess you could say.
Yeah, pretty much.
So we don't really know what's going to happen until probably 3 to 4 hours from the end of the race. Then we can really guess on what's going on. Currently a gaggle of cars, however, two of them are racing for position. That would be Vortex Sim Racing in the number 20 car and Virgil Racing in the number 2 car.
Yeah, that's the white and black and red McLaren on your screen, followed by the yellow, silver, black and white roof. And that is a battle for 5th and 6th. Your Guiz and Stefan Michelar, which is a name I consistently pronounce differently, but at least I'm consistent, I guess. So that's 5th and 6th, but yeah, they're in a gaggle right now. It's a little bit difficult for them to work their way through and battle each other. A couple of cars ahead of them is Robin Frischkopf in the NX Racing blue car in 4th. And P2, NX Racing red, are in the pit lane. Don't think Redline is coming yet.
Vortex Sim Racing just pit. Now, on the first pit stops, I don't want to get this wrong, but I believe NX Racing Blue went one extra lap than NX Racing Red, so I believe it's going to happen once again here.
I was incorrect. Team Redline have pitted already.
Yes. They started the whole pit stops for the top five positions. Glacier Racing pit first.
Yep.
Also want to note that NX Racing Red switched drivers from Jake Sturgis back to Isaac Price. Alexei Yusi-Yakula for Team Redline stayed in the car.
Yeah, so that's Isaac Price's second stint, started the race and then switched out and then is back in again. Yakula, meanwhile, that's his second consecutive stint with Enzo Benito starting the race and also setting that pole time as he's done 3 times this season.
Yeah, it's crazy what we thought. Maybe the McLaren didn't have the advantage this race, but Enzo wasn't gonna have that, so he made sure he got pole.
Equalator's been getting closer though. You might get all five, but you can never know. So I think the next track, the Circuit of the Americas, is a very different challenge to the first three tracks we've raced on. Lots of tight bends and totally different experience. So depends. I mean, I'm sure he's fast everywhere, but at least it's something a little different. Maybe someone else has some strength in the tight stuff, and we'll challenge him for pole.
Whoa, and oh man, GT Rose Silver, sorry about that. Whoever was just watching on stream, you just saw GT Rose Silver very sideways out of the final chicane.
Yeah, that Samuel Dua Fuente got away with it. He's been followed by the Carl Modig KRT Motorsport car, although that car is P25, whereas the GT Ross car that we're watching is the current race leader, but obviously hasn't made its second pit stop yet. Like you say, stays out a little longer than a few of the other guys.
Yeah, NX Racing Blue has just made their pit stop, so they went one lap longer. A lot of other cars in the mid pack pitting right now. Hard to really watch any battles currently due to the fact that we don't know which ones have new tires and which ones don't. Well, we do, it's just hard to keep track of all.
Indeed. So yeah, just had R4R come in. NWSS, GTRS Azure, Direct Clutch, JCL Sim Racing 2, US United Sports Car Sim Racing, Frenzy, NX Racing Blue, while pulling into their pit box.
Actually, I have an odd situation here. It's not as odd as what I'm going to basically explain, but Jorn Jens for Coanda SimSport is actually ahead of Team Redline right now, and it's not because they have haven't pit yet. Well, it is theoretically, but they've done the same number of pit stops, so you're wondering how could they be ahead. Well, when they fixed the damage, had fast repairs, so their car repaired instantly, and then also they didn't have to take as much fuel and whatnot, which probably is about 20, I don't know exactly how much fuel, maybe 15 seconds worth. And also the fresh tires that they've been on while Team Redline's been on older tires. But essentially they've been able to, actually 11 seconds ahead of Team Redline currently. So if they could extend their fuel runs by a lap or so, probably a lap each stint, it might end up equaling out. But I think they're gonna lose so much time doing that it's almost not worth it. It's almost worth just pushing harder and doing one lap less maybe and doing just an extra pit stop at the end.
Yeah, indeed. But yeah, it's currently net fourth, but we'll probably have to pit in about 20 minutes or so.
Yes, they're currently 17 laps into their stint, so they can, I don't even know if they can do another 10 laps, maybe only 9. Samuel's actually still going. He's currently on lap 27 of his stint. Just really quite far. Now, also want to note that he was behind NX Racing Red pretty much that entire stint. So he was saving fuel and whatnot.
Yeah, that probably helps him now. And yeah, remains 54 seconds ahead of Virgil Racing. He also haven't stopped for the second time. And GT Ross Orange, who haven't stopped for the second time. So he's actually 1 minute 30 ahead of Team Redline, which is a little less than a pit stop. Well, yes, less than a pit stop. So yes. When he pits, he will come out behind them, and probably behind NX Racing Red and Pure Racing as well. Looking at a net fourth.
Looking at Team Redline's past two lap times, it was an 18.7, then now a 19.0, while GT Rail Silver here is running, in the 20s. So it's, it's pretty clear that those fresh tires are going to help, almost 2 seconds worth. So even though they came into the pits, I think it was 7 seconds, the gap between the two cars, maybe even 8 seconds, it's going to broad back out to 10 to 12 seconds.
Yeah. In terms of the the pace relative pace between the red line and NX Racing Red as SST Silver, GT Ross SST Silver pit. The pace difference currently sees NX Racing Red about 0.3 seconds faster than Team Redline over the previous lap, and the gap is down to 7 seconds between those two. But after when GT Ross SST Silver has finished their pit stop, the leader of the race, as we say before, will be Coanda, but they are out of sync. And so Team Redline will eventually take the lead again, assuming NX Racing Red don't pass them in the meantime. I think that's about as clear as mud. And, Car 38 just lost it at Le Coombe. That's the Slow Fins team. A very distinctive looking car, that. It is, if you can't see it on the stream, it is, it's red, but with, like, it looks like a sofa. Like a luxurious red sofa with various warning signs on it saying, like, slippery surface and 60 miles an hour. And also the Masters of Endurance logo is upside down.
Yeah, I think it's one of those cars that we have to look at. It's just a huge warning label, which is weird, actually. It should be a warning, because Finnish drivers, we don't normally see them as slow. So, I mean, I don't think these guys are slow by any means, but they're labeling themselves as that, so therefore we're going to have to call them that.
Yep. 48th position currently. Teemu Tuikka currently on board. So the gap between Coanda and Redline is 8.3 seconds. As they now go past the SST car that's in the pit lane.
Yes, and the gap between Redline and NX Racing Red is only 7 seconds, so I don't know. Interesting to note that, actually.
Yeah, it's gone up slightly.
Well, yeah, I expected that from the Redline having one lap fresher tires, but it doesn't seem like it's really affected too much. I believe it was around that when the pit stops started.
Yeah, it's been pretty stable. It went a little below 7 minutes, back up to 6.84 now. So yeah, it'll be interesting once they're both out of traffic, because I think the Redline car just had to negotiate a bit of traffic there. Yeah, it did. Yeah, it'd be interesting to see how their relative pace continues. And also the relative pace between Price and Jakola, who we've not seen on track at the same time so far this race.
Yeah, they're kind of, I don't know a better way of saying it, like sizing each other up, seeing, you know, who has what pace and whatnot currently. I think these two drivers may have a little bit closer. Isaac may be a little bit of an advantage later in the stint, but I also believe that Alexei had quite a bit of traffic his first stint, so hopefully that kind of dies down this second stint for him. Just to see what his true pace really is. Currently on screen is Vortex Sim Racing, currently in P5, battle with NX Racing Blue, who has switched from Robin Friskrops to Simon Cattell. Vortex Sim Racing choosing to stay with the same driver, actually, for the first 3 hours of the race. Looks like also New World SimSport, the number 44 car, has disconnected. Not on purpose, of course. They timed out of the server. Therefore, I've lost quite a bit of time. Well, Simon Cattell there doing a nice clean pass on Joel Guys. NX Racing Blue versus Vortex Sim Racing. Further back, we have, let's see here, we have the famous Le Mans lover, Jonathan Vitale. Doing a pretty good job here, top 25 position.
So I think everyone, yeah, the lead, well, aside from Coanda, the pit stops have shaken themselves out. So we'll just take you through the order. So it's currently Coanda leading, but they will lose that lead once they have to pit for the third time in about 10 minutes. Redline second, Innex Racing Red in third, GT Ross SST Silver in fourth. Innex Racing just took fifth on this lap, Vortex Sim Racing now sixth, Virtual Racing seventh, Iberica eighth, Glacier ninth, and Core Motorsports in tenth. Closest gap in that top 10 was the battle between Innex Racing Blue and Vortex, but that battle now resolved itself. The next battle down the road is pretty much the battle between JCL Sim Racing and GT Ross SST Orange, the 91 and 19. Well, it was. It's no longer that. It's no longer the case, I don't think.
Yes, JCL is currently side by side with the back marker.
Yes.
In the background, I think we just saw Ben Testing spin.
Yes, indeed. At the bus stop chicane, he's recovering. What happened there? So odd place to go, but no, he lost it by himself, actually. There was two cars going side by side in front of him, and he just lost it. And uncharacteristic mistake.
Yeah, that portion of the track, you go up. I say you go up. The chicane is basically two little uphill hairpins, and it can, if you hit the rear tire on the curb just right, accelerate at the same time, it can really just pop your car around, which I believe is what we saw there.
Oh, and you just saw the GTO Ross orange car. You might not have seen it on the stream because it was looking down the straight, but it was a bit of a close call. The JCL Sim Racing car that was in 13 had to take a slowdown and was very, very slow and nearly got clipped by the Christian Laurent orange GT Ross car. Although I'm sure Christian had it covered, but it looked a little close from where I was looking. But that is a change of position. GT Ross SST orange car now in.
Oh, wait, see, 38 car?
13. That's slow fins. 38 spun.
Well, now that their car's sideways, you can see big warning labels, so everyone should be able to avoid this.
Yeah, he sensibly recovered on the grass, so he did lots of little turns on the grass not to get anyone's way. That's a good example of how to have an accident and not affect anyone else.
Exactly. Everyone else, they just got the caution flag, and when they came around the corner, they saw everything was okay.
So I think there was a change of position on this lap between Team Camaro, Ben Tusting, and All-Star Racing Team 1, Harold Stadler. Ben Tusting has got past, it looks like, for 15th position.
I know he spun, and then I don't know if he got back by them or not. Or if he just came out just ahead. We also have a battle a little bit further back here. This is Pure Racing Team, and NWSS Scarlet. Pure Racing Team 2. Also want to note that not only has Team Redline been catching on Coanda, which is expected since Coanda are on such old tires, but then also NX Racing Red have been catching Team Redline just a little bit here and there.
Yep, down to 5.5 seconds.
Yes, and if we also might want to note that GT Ross Silver, which was just behind an X Racing Red before pit stops, has now dropped 7 seconds back. So, interesting situation there.
So battle between Pure Racing Team 2 and NWSS Scarlet, that's being resolved now. P25 goes to Lars Konrad and Pure Racing went around the outside at Lake Coombe. So this race supported by Blue Flag Racing and also this series supported by IGP Manager. And we have a one of our first giveaways of the 24-hour race. We have a code for 1 year of the service, and it's 2D, the 2D side of things as well, the 2D pack. And we have a code that will be coming up on screen. You can use it's up on screen now. So go ahead and enter that on IGP Manager, which and Phil, you can explain exactly what that will entitle you to.
Yeah, so this is basically a race to see who can put it in the fastest. What this does is it gives you one free year of 2D and whatnot for IGP. It's basically, I believe it's a $50 value. It's pretty expensive. Or not, well, pretty expensive. Sorry, it normally is. I think $50 is expensive, but I'm a cheap person. But this gives you, you know, one free year of it. So go along, play for a year, have 2D. And experience IGP. It's actually pretty fun if you get your teammates or, you know, a group of friends on, do it once a day or once a week even. It's very addicting. Remember also that the first character in that code is a zero.
So good luck. Yeah, that's one use code. Whoever gets it first gets the bonus.
And if you do get it, please be sure to say on IRC chat that you got it. And if don't rub it directly in other people's faces, because there are multiple codes that are going to be coming out. But, you know, you can celebrate.
I believe we have 23 more codes. Is that right?
Yeah, we have one for essentially each app. 23 more as of now.
So back to the action. And it's still close between... In fact, we just got a battle between NWSS Scarlet and All-Star Racing Team 3. That's car 126 and 45. And that was a pass. All-Star Racing Team 3 is now in 26th with Stefan Kenitz at the wheel. And NWSS Scarlet is now down to 27th, Jonathan Patel at the wheel.
Couple of fights that are about to break out here with Team TTL and also GT Ross Orange. Currently side by side going into the final chicane here.
So that is a change for 12th, as you say. Lorente takes that 12th position at the bus stop. Richard Hampstead down to 13th, Team TTL, Matt McLaren.
I actually expected to see this team a little bit higher up than what they currently are. I mean, this is a long race. We're going to see them move forward. But, you know, their qualifying was really strong. Both their team cars were in the top four, I believe. And maybe fifth. Sorry about that. I forgot already. Fifth, yeah, fourth and... I don't even remember. Anyway. Yeah, you know, they qualified good, expected them to do really good. Saw them practicing a lot for this race. But we'll see so far. Only 2.5 hours in, so they have a long way to go.
Indeed. I think there may have been a change a lap or so ago Inex Racing Blue, Simon Cattell passed Virgin Racing Marcus Johansson, I think.
Well, he did pass Vortex Sim Racing earlier. He's had a slower lap time. I don't know.
I saw something spot around anyway.
Yeah. It looks like Vortex Sim Racing has actually dropped down to the 9th position. They look like they have a little bit of damage as well. Could be wrong here. Yes, left front damage for that car.
GT Ross SST Silver has just gained a position. I think that was through a car in the pit lane.
Yes, Jorn Jens is currently in the pits.
That brings Kalander back into line after their issue and their collision, not their fault, earlier in the race. So the gap between what is now the leader, which is Alexei Vusiliakhola for Team Redline, is about 5.7 seconds to Inex Racing Red with Isaac Price at the wheel.
Actually, we might have missed this here. Jorn has not pit. That was my fault there. Going to SimSport have a pit. It's a 2-second gap between them and Team Redline.
Yeah, I think the time went a bit funny there. So they showed up behind on the tracker and then went back ahead again.
That's why I thought they had as well. Some of these bigger tracks, especially with the 60 cars, what happens is the simple fact of when one car is on the very corner of the racetrack, there might be one or two other cars that are on the very opposite corner. And for some reason, sometimes live timing doesn't pick that up. Very odd situation.
Yeah. Yeah, racing does tend to lose cars. Always good fun.
Currently the number 78, number 129, battle for position here. I know that 78 is Ham Endurance team. And then 129 is it's a French GTRS team. Not to be confused with GT Ross.
So joining us in the commentary box is Dylan Sharma from TTL. Their car, 91, currently running in 13th place. How's it going, Dylan? Oh, I think he's muted himself. There he is. Dylan, can you hear us?
Yeah, I got you now.
Hello.
Yeah, not too bad. I've got a few issues with latency and 1Xs at the moment, so I think we're probably going to receive a drive-through anytime soon, but yeah, just being an Australian in the server at the moment is sort of just making life quite difficult for us.
Was that a collision then, due to latency that's occurred?
I'm not sure, but at the moment, every time we go through a rouge, we can't cut it at all. Like, there's a ripple strip when you sort of go on the exit on the left there, as you crest it, and then there's that white line on the inside. And if we cross that by the smallest of millimeters, we'll receive a slowdown. We won't even get a 1x for it. So we've already received, I think, about 8 slowdowns because
Wow.
We've crossed it by the slightest millimeter, and you know there's nothing we can do. So we just got to try and give it a bit more room, and there we go. But yeah, it's costing us probably about 3/10 a lap at the moment.
Yeah, it's a bit ridiculous that can happen.
Yeah, it's not ideal. So we've received quite a few 1Xs on my end. Busy time with the car early on, so I think next time we receive a 1x through Blanchemont, I think we're going to get a drive through. So yeah, that's pretty much set in stone, I think, from the admin side of things at the moment. So yeah, it's not going great, but we'll soldier on. We've still got 20 odd hours to go, so
yeah. I mean, 12th, considering the issues are happening, is pretty good, and a lot of points as well because of the double points. And yeah, it's a good haul of points. Okay, this is your second event, isn't it? You weren't at the first event. You've got a good result last time, haven't you?
Yeah. So yeah, we got fifth at Suzuka, we had a good run, and yeah, we didn't make Road America. We had a few issues with drivers and that, but yeah, we've got a good solid group of guys now. So yeah, running pretty good. Just had a few issues with the setup later on the stint. Goes away pretty quick, but as long as we bring the car home every stint, we should be looking alright.
Yeah, just to say, you just saw on screen, Team Redline now do lead the race. Kalander have finally pitted, So your team, are you all in the same place, or are you spread across the continent?
Well, we're all in Australia, but yeah, we're spread across Australia. So I think most of them are on the eastern side. So they're like Melbourne, Canberra. Richard Hampstead's in the car at the moment. He's from Canberra. I think we've about four drivers or three drivers from our team that are running this race are from Melbourne. So,
How many of you are, I think, this time? We
got five. So, you know, I think just do some stints each, just sort of not worry about having three drivers and heaps of stints. So, we'll have quite a few more guys and sort of just balance it out a bit so we can rest up.
Yeah, it's good. You also have backups then as well, having five drivers.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess for me, like, I'll probably go have a snooze for about 6 hours and come back and do some more laps, so...
Oh yeah, I was going to ask actually, yes, it's always nice to get some sleep in, although when you actually try, you're so buzzed, it's impossible, but you reckon you're going to get a few Zeds?
I don't know if I'm going to get much sleep. I've had one and a half cans of Red Bull, so... Oof. Just trying to keep awake, so we'll see how we go, but... Yeah, I think my next stint's not till like 12 p.m. our time, so that could be middle of the night in Europe, I'm not sure, but it's not for a while yet. We've still got about another 7 more hours till I get in the car, so it's not too bad.
Alright, that's good, then you have a nice little break in between.
Yeah,
I'd be sleeping, but...
Yeah, I think it's about 5, yeah, it's just about 5 a.m. local time here in South Australia, so... Not too bad, as long as our guys can get a good night's sleep overnight and then wake up ready to go all day today. But I think most of the Europeans are, you know, be coming into the night, so they'll be a bit drained, so we might have the edge there a bit, hopefully.
Aside from the horrendous corner cutting problems you've had, are you a fan of this track?
Oh, it's growing on me. I'm not a fan of all the 1Xs you get, but it's a good track and close to good endurance races, and you know, Spa 24 Hours is a huge event, so we're glad to be on the grid and having a strong run so far.
Yeah, I would guess that this track is Europe's equivalent of Bathurst. Not quite as epic as Bathurst, but it's about as close as we get.
Yeah, I'd
maybe aside,
say so.
Maybe aside from the Nürburgring, perhaps. That is just absurd, though.
Yeah, I guess quite to what it means to... Obviously, you guys in Europe, by what Spa means to you, is sort of what Bathurst means to us, so we're pretty close in that sort of sense. So, but yeah, it's a great track, it's nice and flowing, and it's good fun, definitely.
Indeed. So, is there any shout-outs, any websites or anything you want to plug while you're here?
Oh, not really, we're sponsorless, so we just run for fun. We're just having a good time. Shout out to the guys. You guys at RaceSpot TV and broadcast.
RaceSpot.
Oh my god, sorry. Never mind about. Dude, it's too early in the morning for me. Simrace.tv, there you go. it's too early for me. It's way too early for me, but I might get some sleep, I reckon. But yeah, it's a great event that, you know, that they're running here, and it's good that Simrace.tv, there you go, is broadcasting it.
Very good.
All right, by the way, that wasn't a jab at Race.TV, that you guys did an epic job.
you can tell how tired I am.
Just don't think anymore. Contact.
Go to Racing and Gianni, Core Motorsports 33. Core Motorsports 33, off in the gravel. Their rear end is in the tyre wall. They're having to wait for all the cars to go past. That was a Glacier Racing car they were battling with. I couldn't say whose fault it was. And back on the track now, recovering. That was a nasty one. Dylan Sharman from TCL, thanks very much for coming and talking to us, and good luck for the rest of your race.
No worries, guys. Cheers for having me on.
So I'm just going to go back and have a look, see what happened between those two.
I couldn't tell if it was the Glacier car running a little bit wide in the second portion, or if it was Core kind of cutting it a little bit. Could have been lag for all I could tell from that camera angle. Saw it live on stream there.
Yeah, it's I don't know, not enough room given. I'd give it 50-50, maybe 55-45. to Glacier, actually. But, you know, that's one for the admins. If a penalty, if a appeal comes up for it, then we'll see. So, the gap between first and second, red line in X Racing Red, stabilised pretty much. 5.5 seconds at the moment. They lost a bit of time on the previous lap in X Racing. They lost about 0.5 seconds.
Yeah, it's interesting. They're almost stabilised the gap now in between those two cars. However, GT Ross now, their silver car, starting to gain just a tad bit. Remember before I said they're about 7 seconds back from NX Racing Red. Now they're only around 5 seconds.
Yeah, true. So that could be the next battle. Yeah, they've got some very good pace. They're faster than the leaders at this point. That's Alvaro Ramiro at the wheel, lapping faster than Alexius Iacola, who's just two-thirds of the way through his second consecutive stint.
Also, always fine. This is kind of weird to hear, but also find that sometimes when you're the leader, you don't really get that break from the lappers as much around, like get it helping, you know, getting around them and whatnot. But then for some reason, the lappers are like, oh, well, I've been lapped now. So then second and third comes around and they just let you by easily.
Going into Le Coum, car three, the All-Star Racing team of Harold Stadler, who just passed Alexandre Chantouin of JCL Sim Racing, the BMW. That is a pass for 13th. With All-Star Racing Team 1 now in 13th, as you can see. That's the red and white and black roof. And he's just coming up in the rear now of car 12, the AB Racing silver car of Alexander Setano, who's in position 43, so we'll be letting him pass at some point soon. The next car up the road for Stadler, if he is indeed going to get that far, is Danny Guser, who was involved in that incident earlier at Le Coum in 12th position, Core Motorsports 33 car. And he is looking to catch Ben Tusting in that number 54 Team Camara McLaren, who obviously gained a position going past him as he was stuck in the tyre wall. So we're looking at the Ham Endurance team in that light blue McLaren being followed by Lars Konrad in the Pure Racing team. This is a battle for 23rd. It's Martin Solari and at the wheel of the Ham Endurance team McLaren. And it's a dive up the inside.
That is quite a bit of defending there. Yeah, quite a bit of defending and then... I don't know, he was there, but yeah, it was a bit of a late dive.
Yeah, that was Fufania. You don't often see passes like that, Fufania, because the braking zone isn't that big. It's quite a flowing corner, so I'm surprised to see that. But that's 23rd now for Pure Racing Team 2.
Still actually quite a few battles all the way through the field. Obviously, we're not even 3 hours in yet, so the field hasn't spread out that much.
Just looking at Twitter, if you want to get in touch, head on to hashtag IRMOE, or alternatively, you could go onto the IRC chat, which you can find, well, you're probably looking at right now, to be honest. It's at mastersofendurance.net/lifetiming/live. In fact, mastersofendurance.net/live will get you there. Just catching up on the tweets from the last hour or so. Johan Suski posted a nice Instagram picture of the start of the race. Team Camara tweeted, third hour of the 24 hours of Spa. Jamie in the 53 for his first hit and Ben in the 54 for his second. And Phoenix Motorsport, they tweeted, 2 hours in, we're P44. We were running P31, but our drivers missed a pit stall. Hashtag extra drive through. Whoops.
Wow. Yeah, that's a huge hold up there.
Yeah, we've talked about how long the pit lane is, and yes, if you miss your pit stall, that is a bit of a cringe moment, unfortunately.
if anyone was currently watching the stream, which I'm sure there probably was, saw the number 62 there of Trinity Motorsports 3 make a pass on the, what was it, I believe?
Cracks Racing.
Cracks Racing team, number 109.
Yeah, it's P20. And that was, Cedric Finzak on the Cracks Racing car losing that position. And off on the outside of the road there is the Monster Energy Endurance green McLaren. You just see them joining the circuit. Damage on the rear of that car. I wonder what happened.
It looks like quite a bit of damage.
Yeah, he went off the road. He spun on the entry to Puon. And smashed the barrier with the rear of his car. And that, that's a fair amount of damage. But he lost it all by himself.
Three car battle here. 10th position. We were just talking to Team TTL's Dylan Sharman, his teammate Richard Hampstead, currently in the car.
Yeah, indeed, that car at the head of the queue, getting light over the top of Eau Rouge, and that gives Ben Tusting and the Team Camaro car a chance to get through on that P10. On the outside, on the right of your screen as you're looking at it, that white McLaren trying to go around the outside at Lacombe. Now, a bit of latency for the Australia-based team TTL, so probably a bit of discretion there so as not to sort of lag into Ben Tusting. So up to 10th for Camara. Now, behind them is the recovering Core Motorsports 33 car of Genny Gusa. The L looks like the I looks like an L on my screen, so that's great. It's currently in P12, and looking at P11 now in that purple and black and yellow 33 roof at the back of your shot.
Looks like the Core Motorsports car definitely wants to move back up through the field here. They're going for the 6th position, I believe, originally. Now they're all the way back to 11th, so...
Yeah, they were battling alongside Glacier, who are currently in 6th. Yeah, nothing from admins yet on that. Don't know if there's been a protest or whether they considered it to be a racing incident.
Yeah, we're going to see if they protest or not. It looks like the 33 definitely has left side damage from the contact. Don't know about Glacier Racing yet. Haven't looked back at them to see.
Yeah, they're lapping. Last lap was a little slow, but that might just be back markers. So we're at 2 hours 42 into this 24 hours of Spa, the Masters of Endurance season 2014-2015.
Yeah, just started 2015 actually. I'm still getting used to it right in the year 2015. Hasn't been too bad so far.
I was over that pretty quickly, but the only thing I'm not over is people still wishing me Happy New Year when they email me at work.
It's like the first time they see you and it's 10 days past the new year, and it's like, all right, it's over now.
Let's just agree we are in a year and we don't have to talk about it anymore. This race presented by Blue Flag Racing. Thank you to Blue Flag for their support of this event. The series also supported by ITV Manager and Derek Spear Design. So thank you to those guys for their support as well. Currently leading, if you've just joined us, is Team Redline, who lead the championship as well by 15 points. Second place is Inex Racing Red, and third is GT Bros SST Silver. As on your screen, not on your screen, but Guter is now making a pass, number 33, 4P and P10 on Richard Hampstead. The Team TCL car, you can now see it, the orange McLaren defending from Guter, that Core Motorsports car, as they go into Puon now. Good defence from Hampstead.
They both gave each other a lot of room as well.
Yeah, exactly.
These two teams, a bit. Core Motorsports finished 4th last race, while Team TTL finished 5th, and that was almost a late little dive there.
Yeah, another one trying to go through a corner that doesn't seem obviously to be passed as Fannier, but he sort of looked up the inside and then lost heart and nearly lost the car as well. In about 10 minutes, the stream will briefly cut out as we slice it up into manageable chunks to upload to YouTube. So if your stream stops, it should start again automatically, but if it doesn't, just refresh the page and you'll be right back with us. After that sort of half-hearted move, Danny Cuser is still not quite managed to recover the time he lost on Richard Hampstead's team TTL car. That battle for 10th we're still looking at.
Yeah, there's currently two close battles going on. We have another one here with... Well, never mind. I just went by really quickly.
So that
GT Rose Orange.
Yeah, we just had a pass there. GT Rose Orange Lorenta just passed Glacier Racing for 6th at Lacoon. You just saw the end of that.
Yeah, so I remember speaking about them before. They were just outside the top 10, I believe, and now they're in 6th position. So they're definitely moving forward now.
Yeah, GT Rose, if I understand correctly, weren't in the first round, but then were present at Suzuka, and they had a pretty good result at Suzuka. Meanwhile, if you look back at the car 33, still just going through Puan, getting caught up in the dirty air of that TTL Richard Hampstead car up ahead, not able to go through the corner at full speed. Oh, sideways moment there for Guso. Again, possibly some dirty air or just lifting off mid-corner. Unsettles that car. Riding on board now with Richard Hampstead's TTL car, McLaren. You can see that Core Motorsports roof ebbing and flowing, getting close as into the braking zone and then losing time as they accelerate away. You would say that the Guse car was a little faster, but he's just been unable to find a way through. He almost got through a couple of laps ago, but since then he's just not quite managed to find the right opportunity. He's sort of holding himself up. Losing time, and yeah, we can see he's sort of vanishing into the distance now as they go through Eau Rouge.
Yeah, definitely dropped back here.
So bearing in mind, as we were being told earlier by TTL, that they have issues with Eau Rouge and the way that their latency apparently causes them to appear to cut the corner.
They had a drop over here to Coanda, who just passed JCL Sim Racing for the 12th position.
Indeed, yeah, Commander there, the white, purple and orange BMW. Behind them is the grey JCL BMW, so that is now P12. Martin Krunker at the wheel of the Commander Sim. Interesting, I don't know if that was lag, but it sounds like the Commander car is lifting and coasting. And not in, like,
it could be.
Yeah, it sounded like it going into Michelle.
Martin has a supreme driving style, probably top 3 best sim racer in the world, that's for sure. So, who knows, that just might be his driving style, how he drives. Very smooth,
yeah.
And lets off the throttle a little bit before braking.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, yeah, sometimes my racing can exaggerate someone's throttle movements as well, so it can look like they're coasting or actually they're braking. I don't know. I've never noticed that before, but we'll see. I think maybe they're trying to save the fuel so they can do one less stop and salvage something from this race that they were doing so well in, and were caught out, unfortunately, by a car in the middle of the road earlier in the race. Oh, Danny Cuser has lost it at the chicane. The commander car was about to go past him. I'm not sure how he managed that. He did it all by himself. I was looking at him at the time. He just lost it on exit. Oof, that was close with the...
yeah, that was a bit risky.
Let's go away with that. Just going to go over. Yep, lost it by himself. The car went all floaty. It wasn't even on the throttle. It got floaty through the second element of the bus stop. That's the second time that car's been facing backwards this race. Only used to having a bit of a nightmare stint. He lost about three or four positions. He lost three positions and also lost 30 seconds as a result of that mistake. So Richard Hampstead gets a break. He had been looking in his rearview mirrors at that Core Motorsports car for quite some time, but now he's got a bit of clean air, at least behind him. In front of him, there's a back marker to that.
I was going to say behind him now, he just has Co-Anders Simsport breathing down his neck.
That's even more terrifying, Martin Krunker. Yes, on his way. That gap is currently 6.5 seconds, but I would not be surprised if that came down pretty rapidly. The Co-Anders car looks to be about a second faster, lap by lap. So yeah, should be about six or so laps before those two are battling together. Lead battle down to 4.7 seconds now. 4.6, in fact, it's just changed again. So Team Redline though, still ahead. Alexei Iacola. Isaac Price in second in the NX Racing Red car. Not too long away, maybe 10 or 15 minutes from the next round of pit stops. We have a car in the pits, car 66, Team Heusinkveld Engineering. With damage on the rear of their McLaren, they were in position 45, and it looks like they will have had an incident somewhere. Not a scheduled stop, I don't think. Oh yeah, in fact, I've just kind of gone back and had a look at their replay. They lost it in the second part of Eau Rouge, smashed into the barrier, went upside down. So yeah, I think they fast-towed back to the pits. Yes, they did fast-tow back to the pits, so that is a nightmare.
Number 10 car here, Iberica Racing Team in the pits. I was going to say a little bit early, but if you remember, they did pit early last time.
Indeed. So we're just about to, we're just coming up towards the first round of pit stops. We're just going to cut the stream for a few seconds to cut it into a manageable size. So the stream should start automatically again in a few seconds, but if it doesn't, just refresh the page and we'll see you in a moment for the 24 Hours at Spa Masters Endurance.